The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host or guests and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged.
Can we get a cup of coffee in here, please? And hot.
My dog is your mind's best friend.
Wake up, America. You've got a dog that needs walking. That's right, sunshine. Just put on a big pot of strong coffee. And get ready to type your little hate mail with your opinions about kumbaya and flat earth insanity. Stand-up comedy? You want stand-up comedy? Well, we got, well, we've
no,
got
we
sit-down comedy.
No, we don't.
It's time coffee with a dog.
We don't either.
You make me laugh.
Oh, I don't. Oh, I won't need it. Enough of that. Achoo. Achoo. I'm gonna sneeze. Achoo. Good morning, you. No, you. You. Good morning, you. It's Friday. Are you happy that it's Friday? It's Friday, April 12th. 2024, right? It's still 2024. A lot of things happened on this date. The Titanic set sail. Lincoln was shot. Stuff like that. Mark down the number 607. 607, that's the episode number of this crazy little shindig we're going to have here today. And it might end up being one of the craziest shows ever. Or it might just be a dud and put you to sleep. I hope it's one of the craziest shows ever. Now, it might get a little, I don't know, ugly at points. It might get a little, not that it doesn't always get a little ugly at points, but I mean in a different kind of way. I'll explain further in a moment. First, I want to say Stephen, the sitcom Ortiz, is not going to be with us today. I don't know if I'm at liberty to tell you what he's doing. I find it interesting. Well, when he's back on Monday, maybe we'll let him explain what he's not in the hospital. That's good news, right? The first time he's missed a show since he's been part of the show that he's not in the hospital. He's doing something interesting. That's all I can say about that now. But today we got two interesting guests, if they both show up. the first one, David Starr, is a channeler and spiritual mentor, which, you know what, kumbaya all over it. It's got kumbaya all over it, but I would like, well, obviously, what I would like doesn't really come into consideration here, but what I would like would to see a little demonstration of the channeling. You know, can you get OJ on the line? Not. That's not going to happen. We're not going to get OJ on the line because that's not what he does. But that's what I would like. Anyway, that could get a little contentious. Considering my past, my experience with channelers and kumbaya and spiritual healers and all that stuff. We'll try to keep an open mind. And listen, it's not for me, it's for you. I've experienced all this shit, and I'm going to be dead soon anyway. We all know that. How soon? Soon is a relative term, right? Soon could be like 3 minutes. It could be 10 years, depending on your, or it could be 20 years, depending on your point of reference. Soon is a very fluid, flaccid, flippid, floided word. Anyway, so that's going to be the first hour again, if he shows up. You know, this has got to be a quantifier with every single guest now, if he shows up or she shows up. The second hour, Serefine, a U.S. Navy veteran, Pennsylvania State Constable, and he's also a mailman, but a constitutional scholar who's got a live stream channel and a political commentary platform, which seems to be extremely on the right wing. I don't know if he'd consider himself an extreme right wing, or I'm certain he at least considers himself to the right. But we're going to talk about the Constitution document, first written in 1787 and ratified, I believe, in 1788, and then amended the Bill of Rights in 1789. Let's just say it's a 135-year-old document written by guys who are not like you and me. These are not my kind of guys. These are not your kind of guys. You have never met anybody remotely like the dudes who wrote the Constitution. And they have never experienced the world that you live in. But still, we live on their words, on basically their ideas about what government should look like in the United States of America and what the foundation should look like. So we're going to, I'm certain he knows the Constitution. I'm certain he knows what it says in it and the meanings of it. But it's like Bible literalists. You know, people take every word in the Bible as, you know, reality. Like it's a news story or history. Sorry. Am I preaching now? I'm sorry. I don't want to go there. It's too early for me to preach. And it's Friday, and I really need more coffee. So let me bring in the fellas while I sip more coffee. First, say hello to the fabulous Ron Kane, and then you could say hello to the cup pointing GD, who's in my spot. Get out of my spot. Okay. Oh, you were muted. Is the muted GD in my spot, but not in my spot anymore.
Good morning, America. MindDogTV.com.
What about Canada? You don't say good morning to Canada?
No. Earth okay. Day is right around the corner. What do you get for a planet that has everything? Go to MindDogTV.com for truly unique Earth Day gifts, like mugs, t-shirts, sneakers, and more. MindDogTV.com. Right. Enjoy the suffering.
Love it. Does the planet really have everything? It doesn't have I don't know. The planet
except for answers to its demise. But
I think GD just hates the Canucks. That's what we're hearing here.
Yeah.
I love the Canucks, especially Pride.
Hey, how do I sound coming through? Because, I remember I had this mic sitting around, so I'm using.
Well, you were a little low, but I just made you a little louder over here on this end. I have magical powers where I can make you a little louder on this end.
Okay, so great.
You're fine now. You sound good. You sound almost sexy. I wouldn't say quite sexy, but almost sexy.
Take that as an insult, Matt.
No, don't take it as an insult. Everything is a compliment. Everything. Even if I say you're ugly, that's a compliment.
That's good to know.
That's true, because you could be, it could be worse.
That's true. You guys, are you aware of what Steven's doing today? I don't feel like I can disclose it to the public, but do you guys know?
Yeah, he told us yesterday. Isn't he substituting today?
Oh, he did say that?
Yep.
I didn't know. Okay. I must have missed that. I don't know how I missed it. Maybe it was in a conference call before I got there yesterday. He said that.
He said that during the meeting in confidence, and he said, "Please don't mention it in public." Yeah. It was during our meeting. Well,
You know why? Now that the cat is out of the bag and the kid is out of the chair or whatever we say, it's just
the drugs are out of the arm.
Yeah, substitute teaching is hard enough. Right? We used to pick on the we were brutal to substitute teachers. I don't remember ever having one in a wheelchair. So maybe they're gonna cut him some slack just because of the chair.
Yeah, right.
I know, that's pretty funny, right? That I even said that.
Yeah, kids aren't nice. Kids aren't nice. He didn't say which grade though he was teaching.
Yeah, that's
cool. He posted a picture of a kid that is missing the teeth. It looks like a grade school kid, like second grade or something. Because waiting for the second. The permanent teeth to come in after the baby teeth fell out. Looks like that.
Well, he got into a fight with Steven just before a picture. show the picture to the other kids.
So, Steven, I apologize if we let the cat out of the bag. If it really was. It just seems, I did not know that about him, that first of all, he has a teaching certificate and all that stuff. But substitute teaching.
Not every state requires you to have that, does it?
I don't know. What do
it's
I know?
State, it's a state-by-state thing.
I only care about New York State, which we're going to talk about the Constitution later. And I know you guys are not I know you're not extreme right-wingers. And so we – or even right-wingers really at all. But so it might get a little argumentative. It might get a little defensive. It might get a little But it's kind of weird that this guy who is going to be on is a Pennsylvania State Constable, whatever that means. Because here, a constable is on the water. I don't know what in Pennsylvania that means. It's like, because you don't have an ocean or a bay.
No. Well, I know, I know next on my side of the bed, I keep a copy of the Constitution and the Bible and a container of lube next to the bed.
Wow. There you go.
Right next to my bed, I just keep power cords that I find on the street that belong to people who've lost them.
Wow. Dial 1-800-WILLIE-AIRPORT. Willie Airport. I don't know. Something. Yes, you know what? I've seen a little bit of his TikTok channel. It's like, you know what? The guy doesn't seem like a hard. He doesn't seem fully in on the MAGA stuff. The TikTok stuff, it was older, but he was talking about how DeSantis could win. Missed it by that much. Giving advice to DeSantis on how to win the Republican primary. So I find that pretty interesting. Like, you know what? Own your conservatism is what it was his advice to Ron DeSantis. So we'll talk to him. That could be a little weird, but the first one,
he has to define what conservatism is nowadays.
It doesn't
mean the same thing it used to.
Right. But, and I don't want to have the conversation before we have the conversation, but here's the thing about the constitutionalists. Conservative constitutionalists always talk about smaller government, but I don't know, and I'm wondering if he's going to argue with me on this point. The Constitution was an effort to make the federal government bigger and stronger because we had the Articles of Confederation, who they felt were too weak as a central government thing. So the constitutionalists and the libertarians who are constitutionalists and the so-called conservatives now who are constitutionalists who are arguing for smaller government but staying loyal to the Constitution, that seems like it's like an oxymoron or something. It's because the Constitution was an effort to make the government, central government, the federal government, bigger and stronger. So where are we with smaller government, Constitution, big, small? Where we go with all of this stuff? So it could be interesting. I wonder if he's going to argue with me on that.
Yeah, they're supposed to, conservatives are supposed to be about like personal freedom, small government. Then how can you call yourself a conservative if you're like backing abortion? Because right there is the perfect example of personal freedom. the government shouldn't be involved in anyone's body, and yet you're saying it's okay. Take a stand, guys. Take a stand.
But if the government doesn't get involved with what goes on with your body, where would they put the chips? They'd have to put them somewhere. They can't, you know, just put them in our phones and try to track us that way.
Actually, they could, right? Couldn't they? Don't they? Well, they do, right?
Yeah.
Nobody's tracking our phones.
Yeah, because you can use...
call Alex. Alex, you can use Wi-Fi. I'm just going to text Alex Jones. You guys keep going. Alex Jones says, yes, they put chips in your phones. So,
it's like that song by...
funniest text comes along with a little airplane voice thing going on.
I got to say, I love smaller government. It allows me to do the things that I love, which is freebasing creatine and not vaccinating children.
I think most
conservatives like smaller government, so when they take their dick pics and hold it next to the government, it looks bigger.
Maybe you're right.
What's his name? I can't think of a fucking name. McCarthy, Kevin McCarthy. Did you see he came out and kind of basically said... He basically said that he was deceited as the Speaker of the House because one congressman wanted to cover up the fact that he was fucking a 17-year-old.
I don't think that was Marjorie Taylor Greene's thing. I thought Matt did it. And so he was, because I thought he was fucking a 16-year-old.
Yeah.
Was it 17? So now I know that he had details that we never had.
Yeah, well, he basically came out and said that, threw Matt Gaetz back under the limelight of investigation now, because he wanted to stop, because Merrick Garland whiffed on prosecuting or investigating Matt Gaetz for whatever reason. Somebody's got shit on Garland. But then the House Ethics Committee was going to investigate, and Gaetz wanted McCarthy to shut that down. He refused, and then the vacate proceedings started with that. So,
but why say it now? Why not say it back then when he could have probably saved his job if he wanted to keep his job?
Let's get him on the show. You got his number? Get him on the show.
Now, I think all those people keep all that shit close to them until they think they're gonna need it, but by then, for some kind of political advantage, then they wait too long and it just gets worse and worse.
But that's we're 17 minutes something. In, and we're not. There's no channeler here.
I'm sorry. The channeler is here. He's sending a message right through me directly.
I was just gonna say maybe I don't have to email him. I could just like channel him. Or so. You know what? He's probably on the West Coast. Most of these channeler dudes are on the West Coast. I don't know if you know. It's like
the professional ones are on the West Coast.
Well, you have I think you have better connectivity to the channel if you're on the West Coast. Like, definitely Oregon has like, I don't know, they have a better antenna.
Well, the fault lines act as a amphitheater when the sound goes in and it reverberates. You know. Carries
did
better.
Not, did not know that. But I have much experience with channeling. Spent 4 years following a channeler around the world, listening to every channel on the channeling channeler.
And you mean like a ham radio operator?
She's kind of like that. She channeled a guy from Atlantis called Haywin. That was the main guy. And Haywin, for some reason, even though he's from Atlantis, had a Asian accent, which kind of is weird because Asia is in the Pacific Ocean, not by where Atlantis would have been by all the... But so Haywin was the main guy. She would channel him like 3 or 4 times a week. But then she channeled other entities. One of them was the goddess energy. That's all her name was. Like, you know, it's kind of pretentious to give yourself a name like goddess.
Damn it. Let me check that.
Who am I speaking with? You're speaking with the goddess. Oh, come on. Any bitch will say that. But so, you know, I had bad experiences with channelers and kind of very obviously phony experience. Because I've told this story before. There, she was channeling Haywin, and she talked with a lot of siblings and had that kind of going on all the time, even though she had an Asian accent while she was channeling. But she would close her eyes, and all these people would be in a trance, supposedly. And I'd be doing sound with her, for her. And she's supposedly in a deep trance and channeling Haywin, but then look up at me with one eye, and like, my microphone, turn it up a little bit. so, you know, kind of blows the whole illusion.
Haywin is like an audio technophile.
Yeah. But
are you saying that she might be a tad dishonest? Just a tad dishonest?
Well, I think she really believed. See, dishonest, I think delusional. But I actually think she totally believed in what she was doing. And I think if our guest shows up, I would probably say possibly that, you know, it's easy to kid yourself. It's easy to kid yourself. Have you guys ever had any experience with channelers? Like,
yeah.
You have?
Yeah.
Tell me, what?
Back in the day, back when I was starting to be a minister, one of the things we used to do was try to call people's bluff, so to speak. In other words, we try to approach the metaphysics and ESP and all this stuff through a scientific lens. We try to apply scientific technique to those things to see if somebody can do it again and again, and pretty much verify that they are legit channelers or legit, you know, the people that bend the spoons, those people, psychotics, that's it. But those things, this was back in the day, back in like when I was in my 20s.
No, I think those are called heroin addicts if they're bending the spoon.
Oh, yeah. I thought those were the heating the spoon people. but yeah. Huh.
Yeah, the closest I've done is I've done the Ouija board.
Well, that is kind of channeling, according to some people. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm surprised that the ministry even considered there were such a legitimate, there were such a thing as legitimate channelers. I would have thought they would have poo-pooed the whole thing.
The thing is, we didn't poo. Let's put it this way. One of the assumptions is that we don't know everything. It was just an assumption. I mean, we could have been wrong.
Yeah.
But if you were to say that, let's say Matt, you walked in, you know, you advertised yourself as a psychic healer, or and that you've, you know, that you could turn water into wine. Okay. You know, it's like, okay, let's not, you know, let's see this, you know, and then let's see it a second time if you could do it the first time, you know. And then try to figure out how and why such a thing happened. Could it be explained through a natural phenomenon? Do 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 do. Or if if we can't explain through a natural phenomenon do 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 in science, then, you know, is it a hoax? Is it a trick? You know, how is it done?
I'm just looking. It looks like I might have fucked up.
You did.
I might have, because I'm not seeing the message I sent to this guy with the link for today. So maybe I fucked up on this. You think?
Oh, let me check my emails. Maybe you sent it to me. Ron, you check your emails.
No. Yeah. I would not think you're like a divinity coach or whatever. What are
these? Then I'll check the Reverend's email.
Spiritual mentor. Wow, did I fuck up? I'm sorry, people. I fucked you up. I fucked us up. I fucked me up. Is it too late to send it to him now? Will he even get it and be up?
Well, it's 3 hours, so he's got 3 hours to respond, right? Because it'll be 3 hours.
I don't know that he's on the West Coast. I really don't know that. But let me see. Where's the invite guest link here? Invite here. I'm going to do this really quick. You guys chat amongst yourselves for 1 second.
Okay. Ron, did you send out the emails for
No, I haven't.
Okay.
No. I should probably do that.
Especially if you want people to respond by Monday.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I got a promo got to put out there and things like that. So, yeah, I don't know. I've been, a lot of happened this week. So I've been keeping my ass busy with other things.
That's good.
Your busy AI addiction. Thing. Just say it. Your AI addiction. You've probably done like 12 AI videos. You know, half of them nudies.
And yeah, the one thing about that, you got to be, you got to be resourceful when you're using that AI, because it won't let you use certain words and things like that. Like, I had to be really careful on how I worded that little Netflix ad that I made for that show. I hope it's cake. Because I had to do it right, because I was talking about people blowing up when they are eating cakes, possibly. Yeah. So I had to kind of, Adobe definitely helped with that, adding in some of the pictures and things like that.
Yeah, I can't get too dirty with some, because I tried some of, I tried a few like prompts that just were rejected for being bad language or something, you know, not with in video. It was with ChatGPT. It would not let me to say certain things.
Yeah, and it was in video. It won't let you say certain things either. You got to be you just got to be a little creative. That's all. That's all.
Yeah. So Matt, thank you with your help. I finally got at least phase one of what I was trying to do with the video. I got a text.
You know, I didn't go over all that stuff with AI talking, but you can actually bring in your own. You could put your picture in there, or you could put in, you know, celebrities.
Right. That's how I was going to go through. But I just wanted to make sure my first one worked, and it did. It worked. I didn't include pictures yet because I was like really tired, and I don't know what I was thinking. Honestly, I was just so exhausted. And then you sent the email late. I saw the email late, and I was getting ready to go to bed. I checked my emails and I said, fuck. Well, Matt went through all the trouble of sending me this. I'm going to make sure it works. You know, and so I did. And I sent you, I think I said it works. I got it. Thanks. And then I tried it and I was like, right. Yeah. I logged in and said it works. And then I went ahead and tried to do what I was trying to do. And then I got stuck for like another half an hour playing with it. And then I was
exhausted. Everybody, you're listening to Tech Corner with GD Fenderson.
All right. Yeah, you know, I'm trying to, you notice how I zero in on all that technical language?
I definitely sent the Constitution guy his link. I was just checking to make sure that I sent him the link. I don't know what I definitely fucked up.
I'm just ready for someone to tell GD. He's like, is it plugged in? Have you checked if it's plugged in?
Yeah. Or did you find your power cord? I still don't know what the future is with Willie. I haven't heard from him. Steven keeps saying I'll talk to him, and then I never hear. You know, be good to
the future. Know exactly if you're is airplanes.
Well, the problem is Steven will talk to him. Steven say something like, "So, Willie, what's going on with you?" And then Willie will talk, answer back for 20 minutes, but never answer the actual question. Yeah. So
well, you know,
has no update.
I will say that, you know, I don't know if you know this about me, but well, I will say,
come to think of it, let me go back 20 more years. You said, realize you weren't born 20 years before then. Oh, yeah, well, then 20 years before that,
you know what I mean?
My great grandpappy.
You know what? I took a transcript of a Lord and Lady show, and I did a search for, you know what I mean? And I highlighted all of them. There was 176 in an hour. And then 176, you know what I means. And then 384, you know. And I said, you got to cut down on.
When I first started comedy, and like I would go back and listen to you know, my recordings. Oh, that was such like a terrible crutch for me, where I would go, I mean, like, or just it was horrible.
I know it's hard to break out of those habits, but when it's pretty prevalent when you just print it out in a transcript and then you highlight them all. It's like, whoa, look at all those highlights.
Yeah. And you really, like, especially for me, like, I kind of zoned in on that because, like, I hate listening to people talk when they have horrible crutches like that, whether it be like an or just some little crutch like that. Because then in my mind, I start, like, my mind wants to start counting them. I'm like, what is going on here?
That's OCD. That is really OCD. He has like, and all of a sudden, I want to know how many times he says that. And do I count the ones that he
said? The Channeler guy is here right now. Let's say hello to the Channeler guy. Hello, Channeler guy.
Hey,
Channeler man.
Hey. Because you're across the channel. That's it. I got it. He's across the channel.
He's in my spot. Everybody likes to take my spot.
And the ocean. Can you hear me?
Ocean.
Yes, we can hear you, OJ. We can hear you, OJ. How's it look in hell?
OJ's criminally, he's innocent. He was found innocent, young man. So don't discount.
No, not innocent. Our judicial system does not say innocent. We say not guilty. Guilty and not guilty.
Let me get this other microphone off here.
And allegedly.
Somebody's been on the program. I'm not going to say her name. So somebody has been on the program with dolls and puppets.
Okay.
I'm not going to say her name. She was on Facebook saying about, rest in peace, our good friend, Orenthal James Simpson. She said, I feel conflicted about saying this because so much negativity about him, but I know he found God and he was really nice to me and my boyfriend and whatever.
He may have found God, but he was looking for his trophies.
Right. So, no, he was looking for the real killer. And
but then somebody stole his trophies and he got distracted. So he had to find his trophies before he could find the real killer.
Great athlete in some amazing, a few amazing comedy movies. Entertaining on Twitter. He did cut someone's head off in LA, but.
Allegedly. Yeah. Guilty. Again, remember, he found not guilty of cutting somebody's head off.
I watched 20 minutes of Norm MacDonald's. OJ jokes yesterday because those
I knew that was going to come out
ones. It's so great when he's like, oh yeah, he murdered them.
And it makes it even better when you know that behind the scenes the boss was saying, don't do that, stop, don't do it, and he just kept doing it anyway. Now a conspiracy theory came out that I had not heard of, but people swear it was a thing then, that OJ took the fall for his son Jaden or something like that. I don't know. I remember the kid's name, but they were saying that his son was a prime suspect for a while, and OJ took the fall for him. And I was like, that's a stretch, man. The kid had really no motive and no training. Remember, OJ had the training from the Navy SEAL on how to cut somebody's head off just before that and all that stuff. And also then the strength
to do what he did, they said it'd be someone about the size of, an NFL player, because you need to be really strong to be able to do what he did to those bodies.
Yeah. And the Bronco run in the border, the kid didn't do that. OJ did that. I mean, if you were covering up for your son, you would just go surrender yourself. You wouldn't make a run for the border with a gun at your head. I don't know. It just doesn't make
sense. I think I would. I'm not sure. I don't think you appreciate black culture, Matt. I really don't think you appreciate true black culture.
You need to feel seen sometimes.
Explain to me what would make you run for the border in the backseat of a Bronco while your best friend is driving the Bronco.
It's a black thing. You wouldn't understand. I could take the entire day explaining it to you, and you wouldn't understand because it's a black thing.
You're assuming that I'm too stupid to get it.
No, you're too white.
Maybe he wanted to spend time with his kid. You don't know this.
I have a play button right here.
I don't like how you're being so judgy on his parenting skills.
All right. But so she was on there saying what a good person he was, and he found God. This is like, I don't think you were really friends with him. Right. I think, you know, because to that extent, I was friends with him on Facebook, but that doesn't mean
I think her puppet was actually friends with him, and that she wasn't.
I would have liked to have hung out with OJ for a couple of days. You know,
really?
Yeah, play around with golf, get some of that Hello Twitter World stuff in person. Why not? I don't think he would try to kill me.
Did you also have this desire to have wanted to hung out with, let's say, Jeffrey Epstein for a day?
I'm not sure about Epstein. Now, Jackie Martling, friend of the show, is a very good friend of Jeffrey Epstein, so we shouldn't go up there. You can hang out of his New York mansion, which is a blackmail operation by Mossad and the CIA. I know about Epstein. I would hang out with Trump and I'd hang out with OJ. I think it'd be interesting. A couple of days, you know.
I just want to say
I never took my underwear off. That's all I want to say.
I'm just curious because I'm sure England has at least like six black people, right?
Seven.
Seven. Okay. Wouldn't you rather hang out with one of them than, let's say, a notorious black guy from the United States, like was it P. Diddy? Who are we talking about again?
OJ. One of the crazy isn't the entire rap community just sex trafficking women? Isn't that every hip hop star is just sex trafficking women?
I'm starting to think so.
Yeah, they can't a lot of rappers just can't get out of their own way. It's like sex trafficking or like they're still pushing.
Not the white rappers
making money.
You never see Eminem getting in any trouble. You never see Vanilla Ice. Well,
no, he's got privilege.
Two-tier system. Two-tier policing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Eminem's got to get out of what's it called?
Chocolate.
Free card.
Oh, I thought you were talking about.
And Eminem. He's got mom's spaghetti too now.
That's right.
His mom's spaghetti. I wonder if she made good meatballs because I tried to make spaghetti and meatballs the other day. Here's the thing. My wife had never seen The Godfather. I know this is like, don't judge me. I tried to get her to watch The Godfather for the last 15, 16 years, but she just refused. But then Sunday night, I got her to watch Godfather 1 and she liked it. And I said, I feel like spaghetti and meatballs, but it was late and we went to bed.
It's got to be Godfather 2 this weekend, right? What's going on?
Godfather 2 the next night. And first of all, the next day I went out and I got stuff to make spaghetti and meatballs. And she knew I was making meatballs. And she said, and then I put on Godfather 2 and she could hear the music. She said, you're kidding me. You're making spaghetti and meatballs and watching The Godfather 2 all at once.
But now, when you left the house to get the spaghetti and meatballs, did you just like, here I am reinforcing stereotypes and just walk out the door?
I didn't do that, but yeah, I knew in the back of my mind that's what I was doing. Absolutely. But for some reason, I don't know, it's a trigger point for me. I watched The Godfather and all of a sudden I got to like have sauce going on in the kitchen. I got to smell Italian.
Yeah, you got to keep pretending you're Italian like all Italian Americans. You got to maintain appearances. You'll be in a tracksuit with a gold chain next.
Yeah. There really is no Italian, right? This is what I'm learning. As we've had guys on from Italy, and Italy is like Israel. It was no, there was no real Italy until like 1948 or something like that. There were different provinces. It was like nation states that were all kind of lumped into that Italian. Yeah, well,
Sicilians aren't Italian, so most is like The Godfather. Like, they don't see themselves as Italian at all. It's a different country as far as they're concerned.
Right. They even mention Apollonia, Michael's first wife, as more Greek than Italian. So you know, the island of Sicily was people from the mainland of Italy. There were people from Greece and the Moors that came in from Africa and just raped everybody.
The great Christopher Walken speech from True Romance.
Yeah,
it's funny. I thought when as soon as you said Apollonia, I was thinking of the young lady from Prince.
Right. Yeah, same here, GD. That's the first thing I thought of too.
And I thought like sex shooter, you know, Apollonia 6.
Little trivia fact for you. The first titties I ever saw in a movie theater on the big screen.
Your mother?
My mother actually took me to see The Godfather when it came out. I was 12 years old.
Have some respect. It was his aunt.
And she tried to make me look away because she knew the titties were coming out. But I Apollonia was, you know, she did the thing with the nightgown and then the titties come out. And they were like hard titties. Well, pointy hard titties.
What year was that?
Huh?
Because mine was it was probably 1969. No. It was If He Hollers, Let Him Go. And I was so in love with her for like the longest time.
Now, how did you get into that? Had to be rated M or R at the time. Mature audiences only R.
No, I went in with my sister. My sister used to take real titties. Yeah.
Wow.
I think one of the first tits I saw in a movie were three tits on that woman in Total Recall. And I was like, I was really like spoiled. Eight or nine, I think. Yeah, I thought everyone just had three tits.
Well, there are plenty of 80s movies out there that are like PG rated, and they have like almost full nudity and topless women. Yeah,
but by the time the 80s came around, they loosened the PG rating so that 13 or older was suggested, but not enforced.
So now when you watch a movie, there's no titties, but they'll warn you that someone is smoking in the movie.
Or using bad language. My wife and I was watching something on, it may have been Netflix or something, and it came up with all these warnings of all these things that I'm like, you know, maybe smoking, there may be a drug reference, a suicide reference. And it's like, oh yeah, it may have been John Wick, and 37 people get shot up and killed or something. I don't know.
Well, to be fair, nobody ever got cancer from titties that I know. Well, women get cancer from their own titties.
Yeah,
but nobody ever got cancer from smoking a titty or something, right?
Only if you inject.
No, but guys,
I don't read the warning labels or the how-to label. I don't read the instructions. I just just jump in, titty, titty, titty. But I don't know where I was going with that. The first titties I ever saw on the big screen were that, and it's every time it comes, it's like reliving a magical moment. Where every time I see that scene, it's like I'm back to prepubescent me.
I saw a lot of like softcore. You know, pretend porn. Like
by the time you were a teenager, you could rent VHS of hardcore stuff in the back of a video store.
I was too ashamed to do any of that stuff. I just had to wait for stuff to come on TV.
But my era, I mean, basically, the big thrill was going to the bookstore in the mall. And there were naked. There was books that had naked pictures of Marilyn Monroe in it, and those were exciting for me as like a 10-year-old or a 9-year-old. We would sneak to that section of the bookstore that had the Marilyn pictures on it.
Is anyone going to see that movie Civil War this weekend?
I only heard about it yesterday. I don't know much about it.
It was like trending, and people were talking about it. Now the cast. Yeah. Of the movie were coming out and being political and talking about current times. I didn't even know there was one being made. Is it about the American Civil War? Is that what it's about, or is it
It takes place. It's event? Modern. Yeah, it's it takes place modern day, and there is civil war that breaks out in the U.S. and like Texas and California for some reason have joined up. It's a, you know, succeed. And
plot twist. Texas and California hate each other. If you're paying attention.
Yeah, Russia and China used to hate each other, bro. Come on. This is the Illuminati telling you what's going to happen in 10 years.
That's a fair point. But everybody was leaving California, going to Texas, because of the tax structure and all that stuff. So all the people from California were going to it's hard for me to see Texas hooking up with California, like the complete opposite. It's like communists and fascists getting together.
Maybe it's like a drunken night where, you know, like you get two people who don't like each other hook up. You know, you get enough alcohol involved and they hook up.
That could happen. It's a fair point.
Yeah, you wake up and you're in bed with a fat Civil War activist. Now it's on with Oregon.
Well, and I've heard like one of the things that's supposed to be it, like the movie is supposed to be good, And
give it a go.
Some people were a lot of people were frustrated because the movie does not take a side at all. It's just like, this is what's happening.
That's a good movie then. That's a good movie then.
Or written by AI.
This is the thing that's happened.
Who's the star? Is there any star power in it? Like name?
Yeah, Kirsten Dunst is in it. I think she's the biggest actress in it. And then there's I forget the guy's name, like Jamie something, and he's a very good actor too.
Nick Offerman, Jesse Jamie Plemons, Bond. I think was in Breaking Bad.
Yeah.
Do we know if there is any titties in the movie?
You would hope so.
I wouldn't see it. I mean, that's my incentive.
Just Nick Offerman's, I think.
It's that guy Jamie's titties, and that's, you know, I'm not really all that interested.
Yeah, the biggest stars are Nick Offerman and Kirsten Dunst.
I don't know. I'm sorry. I
if he's not Marilyn Monroe, I don't know who it is.
I don't really know their work. You know, I'm culturally unhip. We know that. We don't have to bust my balls every time it comes to light that I don't know anything about modern pop culture.
Kirsten Dunst was in Spider-Man 22 years ago.
Never watched Spider-Man.
She was also in an End of the World movie where...
I was a Spider-Man cartoon enthusiast when I was 7 years old. So, you know, I'm not going to watch movies now. That would ruin it for me. I like Spider-Man the cartoon. Spider-Man. You know?
No.
All right. Fuck you guys.
Does whatever OG Simpson can.
Fuck you guys. The comedians now going I don't know, on a soapbox about other comedians making jokes about OJ. Like they're dusting off 30-year-old jokes and all this kind of stuff. You guys seeing a lot of, because I'm seeing that all over social media. Like, it's always the comedians who like are basically been doing open mic nights for 6 months or something that are lecturing the entire comedy community about what they should be doing and what they shouldn't be doing and all this stuff. But are you seeing it like I am?
Oh yeah, as soon as it broke. It was, they were out in full force, you know, with the jokes or whatever you want to call them. Then you get your faction of comics like, oh, it's, you know, it's not cool. It's, you know, it's just, you're just jumping on the bandwagon. So, yeah, it normally happens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The biggest criticism, if you're going to do it, make it original, which I think is fair, because just to dust off like an old Norm Macdonald bit and call it your own, that's not being a comedian. That's just being a douchebag like me. But I mean, it's so, if you can come at it with, but how can you come at it with anything unique when it's been joke fodder for 35 or 33 years or whatever, 30 years. Whatever.
Yeah. Like, as soon as I heard that he had died, the first thing that came to my mind, I wrote it down, and then I sent it to two friends of mine. One is like documents that if someone else comes up with a thing, at least you know that I thought of it at this point. I'm not stealing it. This is my thought. And also, usually, it's like also a test, like to see if they say, okay, I've heard that before. You know, and then they can stop me before I kill again. Yeah. So I sent a joke to two of my friends. As a matter of fact, Ron, you probably know both of them, Tom Myers and Frankie James.
I know both of them. They're both good guys. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, Frankie James, actually, you probably do know. You probably have seen him because he's been in a lot of movies.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know Frank and Jesse James.
Not that one. Okay. A different one. This one's black. But y'all have like the same shaped head, so you'd like them.
Wow. So yeah, you know, the people are just going crazy. Now, yesterday, I don't know if you said this on air, but you were talking about Anthony. What was Anthony's last name?
Cassese?
The cop. No, the cop.
The
cop that was here yesterday.
Scrum Kelly.
Yeah, something like that. Anyway, you're talking about him. You said he was basically phrasing his stories, but taking it from like an old Joe, old punchline thing. And I was like, I was racking my brain thinking, what the hell you were talking about? Was it the lug nuts thing? Where
that's one of them.
Where, you know, the mental hospital, he said, I'm crazy, not stupid, that one.
Right. That's one of them, yeah. That was one of them.
I can't think of any others that he was telling that would like line up with an old joke. But that was just interesting to me, like, because that did hit me as like it seemed like a setup punchline type of.
he did it like three or four times. He did it like three or four times. So I was trying not to be a dick about it. I just okay, that's just the way he talks. I understand.
So it's possible for you to put in an effort to not be a dick, is what you just said.
It's possible, yeah.
Usually
I choose not to, but it's one of those things where, first of all, I have deference to people who've made it to like their 70s and 80s, and if I'm lucky, and I may make it that old if I can remain lucid.
Well, you have deference, but you didn't even blink an eye about asking him if the right kids got killed. And you know, you didn't even give him a chance to get comfortable in the seat and realize that he was talking to three comedians and a douchebag. You threw that at him like 30 seconds into the conversation.
Yeah, well,
that's his fault. If he had not brought up the fact
that is not his fault.
If he had not brought up the fact that Russia had executed the wrong person, I wouldn't have even thought about
they killed the wrong guy.
Whether or not they got their kids. You need the toilet flush. I'm telling you, a toilet flush.
Oh, that was me. A little diarrhea.
I know that was yeah.
foul mouth teachers in the room. Good morning. Yeah. I
have to say though, when GD dropped that terrible line, the look on his face.
I know. I felt like I didn't know what to do at that moment. I was kind of like, I gotta let this guy know that he's joking. I don't think he realized that it was a joke. He's like, what the fuck is wrong with this guy?
No, the funny thing is Matt does this one thing with his face. Sometimes when I say he'll go, I can't believe what the.
He recovered nicely. Once he realized.
Yeah, well, I think maybe he might have been mad because he threw off his timing because he probably...
He was about to tell another joke.
Yeah,
he was trying to set up a joke where, oh, we find a body in a wall.
Yeah.
He was trying to, yeah, but it's like, no. First explain yourself, young man.
I didn't even touch on the fact that how odd it is to get... Listen, if a guy murders, if somebody, one person is murdered, I could see that it's pretty easy to get the wrong guy. But 40 victims, I mean, the evidence has to at least be, you have to have some exonerating evidence within 40 victims that say, maybe you got the wrong guy at some point. You got 40 different cases involved, right?
There was a movie about a Russian serial killer, and I think the guy who played the serial killer was a guy named Stephen Ray, but I'm not certain. This was a while ago, and that's why I was trying to find out if that was the same guy, if that was the same case that he's talking about, but because he was like taking children from like, not just children, well, teenagers and children from train stations and stuff like that, when parents used to, back when it was safe to send your kids on the rails alone to go visit your family.
Casey Anthony's trending now because she moved up one on the most hated list since OJ's gone.
What an honor.
I know. Well, you know what? You're advancing on. I don't know if I should send her like a congratulations, a cake. Congratulations. You just moved up one slot on the.
People send me congratulations whenever a comedian dies. Like if a comedian of stature dies, they know I just moved up one.
So congratulations!
I get people congratulating me that I moved up one more spot in the comedy hierarchy.
Who?
Hey, well, the positive is if Casey Anthony invites you to a party, good chances there's going to be no kids there.
Yeah.
At least not the right kids. The wrong kids would be all off to be piled up. Now,
remember she was fucking her lawyer? I'm wondering if that only lasted while he got her off. And then she dumped him like as soon as she was in the clear on that shit. Does anybody know about that? Like,
well, OJ was doing the same thing.
He was fucking Johnny Cochran.
Well, I was thinking of the other guy. There was three lawyers. There's Cochran. There were
lots of more than three. There was Effie Bailey. There was Dershowitz. There was Robert Shapiro. There was that Christopher Darden. Oh no, Christopher Darden was a prosecutor.
Yeah, he was doing Marsha Clark.
But there were four or five attorneys on the.
But there's one who's, and it's, you, with all the ones you named, you didn't name the one that I'm got in my picture in my head and I can't.
Carl Douglas, Sean Chaplin, Holly, Gerald Ullman, Robert Kardashian, Alan Dershowitz, Effie Bailey, Barry Sheck, Peter.
That's Noyes. The one. That's the one I was Barry thinking of. That's the one he Barry was Sheck. Doing.
Barry?
Yes, Barry, yeah, he was.
I wonder what he's Sheck. Up to these days. You don't hear it.
Oh, that guy. Yeah. I remember this guy.
Yeah, the DNA guy.
Yeah.
And he was the Innocence Project guy. Now, I think he got that,
Well, his career took a dive after Sheck Forever. Because it did Sheck 1, Sheck 2, and then Sheck Forever. So after that, you don't hear anything about him.
I remember, it's a serious question, Chris Dixon. I remembered hearing of an actor in films being named. Oh, yes, it's the same one. As a matter of fact, just 3 months before he was arrested for murdering his wife, he was in the last Naked Gun movie where he
93 and a third.
Yeah. But he was in lots of movies. He was in the original, the thing that spawned Capricorn 1. It spawned the moon landing fake conspiracy. It was a movie about. The moon landing being faked and done on a Hollywood backlot. O.J. Simpson was the star of that movie. Him and Sam Waterston. But that spawned the whole, we saw it in a movie. It must be real type of thing. Because that came out in the early 70s or mid-70s. And then all of a sudden, the moon landing was fake became a real conspiracy after that.
Oh, yeah. He did quite a lot in the 70s, including Dragnet, the TV version as well. Towering Inferno. Capricorn, yeah, Goldie and the Fox films. Right. Yeah, he did.
He did a billion. He did a billion Hertz commercials with Arnold Palmer. That was kind of, he was made. So here's what kind of thing that hit me: like, if you could have just refrained from beheading your wife, you could have lived a tremendous life for the rest. If you just could have said, fuck it, she's gone, I lost her, whatever, let her fuck this young guy, you could have remained in movies, you could have had a television career, you could have kept the house in Brentwood instead of going to jail for trying to steal your own trophies back and all that stuff. If you could just, I don't know, how hard is it not to behead your wife? I think it's pretty easy.
That's what she said.
Yeah, and how she said it, and how she said it.
Yeah, it's the intent.
I don't know. I've been angry at women, but
You never even thought about what, like a death plan?
When I was a kid, we used to run molasses out of Canada. Your father, too. And there was a kid who looked kind of green. He looked up to me, and that kid had big dreams, and he built a city. That was in a stopover for GIs from California in the middle of the desert, and nobody gave that kid a chance. I knew Mo. I knew he was a little headstrong. He was talking loud. So when he ended up dead, I didn't ask who gave the order. I let it go. Because it's business, not personal.
I would hope, like, since he's dead now, that the Goldmans would release a diss track on him. That's what I would like.
Now, can they ever get their money?
That's cowardly. No. You got to give him a chance to respond.
Oh, he can respond in hell. I mean, come on.
According to Andy's wife, he's not in hell.
Well, he's not.
That was a breaking news this morning. Andy's wife is Jehovah's Witness. And
he's been sent to Ohio.
You know.
Well, Jehovah's Witnesses don't quite believe in hell.
Oh. I did not know that. So that explains her statement that he's not in hell. That line called before reminds me of my uncle saying, my friend was eaten by a shark, and I asked, how's he going to feel about the experience? I can't ask him because he's dead. All right. Got that pouring water sound?
Yeah. Yeah, no, that one was a little rough, so.
Yeah. I don't necessarily believe in hell either. I think this is hell, and especially in the winter.
And if you've ever been to Michigan, I mean, it's a close call.
I could think of worse places than Michigan. Well,
I like Michigan. Parts of it.
Have you ever been to Flint, Michigan? It's not great.
Oof. Yeah, Flint's a rough one. There's lots of rough.
I worked in Detroit. I worked in Detroit for a few years.
That's pretty rough too. I mean, listen, Jerry, when Detroit in the '60s, when Detroit was on the top of the baseball world, the Denny McClain, Mickey Lolich years, they were having baseball games in the middle of race riots all around the stadium. Stuff burning. You could see buildings burning in the background. And all that stuff. And then, you know, Detroit went through the auto industry kind of leaving Detroit and leaving it in poverty. Not a good place now. Dave Landau, Ian's favorite comedian, talks about the line in the Journey song. Just a small town boy born and bred in South Detroit or whatever. He says, took a midnight train going anywhere because anywhere is better than Detroit. So, you know, I don't know. Detroit, you say there's I don't see anything nice about it. You could buy a house like this in Detroit for $37.
Yep.
And that pays with the taxes and everything.
Is there not one good part of Detroit? There's not one corner?
You know. I don't know. Who would stay there? It's like dystopia, right? I don't know. Am I talking out of my ass? I don't know. I am talking
out of my ass. You should go. You should go and tell us.
If you get out of Detroit, there are some like really good places in Michigan, but you know, of course around the lake, but that's all going to be the Richie Riches. But yeah, I mean, there are decent towns there. I mean, Flint is not a great town because everything they've gone through, and but when I was out there working, this is like 10 years ago. And this is before the whole water thing and all that.
About Flint and that and the auto industry from the Michael Moore documentary.
And it has a very, very high crime rate. But talking to the people there, like, yeah, it's bad, yes. But it's not as bad as people think. There's areas. But if you pull up the crime map, it's like all red.
I think it's Flint. There's a really good documentary on the police force and they have no money. Like they just get no money. So yep. There's like four cops for the entire town over a weekend.
Yeah. They have the highest crime rate in the nation, Detroit. As I looked this up last week when somebody was bitching about cities, urban cities being out of control. And, you know, because they were bringing up New York. And I was like, you know, I walk the streets of New York never, ever in fear that I'm going
to get I think it's more the northern part of New York, isn't it? Sort of above the park. That's where you're going to get shot by going in a fucking... weed store.
Yeah, but I don't think there's I think that perception of New York is overblown. My whole life I've been around New York City. My whole life, but most a good portion of my life I've been around New York City and never once felt in danger. I felt great. There are crazy people there. And there are all sorts of people. You don't want to make eye contact with the nuts, but that's everywhere. But that
I felt in danger at 3 a.m. at Penn Station and then even no, it's 1 a.m. at Penn Station in Manhattan and then in Newark at 3 a.m. That's when I thought I might die. What do I do? And then I got, yeah, I mean, the crazy fucking homeless people that look like they want to murder you and are telling you they want to murder you.
In Penn Station, there's cops everywhere, right? Or there used to be.
There's like four cops and 100 walking dead. It's not at 1 a.m. not good. Yeah. And I don't know why that's allowed to happen, because like here that just gets cleared out. You make it secure for people. You get the odd nut, but especially in Newark as well, it was literally like a scene from The Walking Dead. I was like, I don't want to go outside. There were two cops on the door. And then I got into an illegal cab.
You don't have a constitutional right to be a homeless person out there.
God damn it, that's why.
But, you know, no matter where you go, people will tell you, like, anything after midnight is sketchy. Even in small towns we have here in New Cumberland, you know, they close before the pandy, everything was open till 2 a.m. But then since then, they now kind of wrap up at midnight now, because all the bars got together and they said, you know, after midnight, nothing usually happens good in our places. You know, something happened. Yeah. So now everything closes at fucking midnight in that town.
It's happening here more because of the cost of running a bar. It's so expensive. A lot of bars keep their power off until the second they open. And if there's a few customers in at 10, 11, they'll just shut. Because they're not going to stay open for 2 hours.
Even the Vatican closes at midnight because they know how priests get.
Like Ron's hat. I don't see really Ron's hat. I just see the lid of Ron's hat. What does your hat say? What does it say anything?
Nope. It's just the Chester the Cheetah.
Oh. All right.
It's my former employer, since my job is in Mexico now.
Yeah. The bars in New York, up before COVID, I have my whole lifetime closed at 4 a.m. I don't know if that's still... I think they're closing earlier now. I think they're closing at 2 a.m. Most of the United States was like a 2 a.m. closing in bars and stuff. But New York always stayed up until 4 and then reopened at 5. Like, you just had to close.
Long enough to get the glasses out of the dishwasher.
We closed. We closed.
And like the Tampa area, a lot of the bars actually stay open until 3 a.m.
Wow. Yeah, 3 a.m. is not bad. And
Tampa is because of the roundabouts. They want to give people time to... They want to give enough people time to get off of the roundabouts before the drunks get stuck on them.
No, I think they're just waiting for people to come down from the bath salts. That's what they're worried about.
Do they open up again like at 5, or is it, or they wait like till noon to open up, like let people recover from the drunk before they start drinking again?
I think between like 11 and 12, most of the bars open up. Maybe some at 10 a.m.
Yeah. Airport bars never close, right? Airport. Maybe I should call our airport correspondent Mexico. Do they ever close? I don't think they do. Airport bars, they basically stay open because they know you need to get drunk to be on.
Well, rest areas seem that some of the places close. If they're individually owned or operated, you would think that they're responsible for their staff, and if they can't staff it 24 hours, why stay open 24 hours?
Well, I think you make a good point. I think maybe you have to, I don't know. Well, I'm talking out my ass again. I'm talking about things I don't know.
All the traveling I did in Florida, every rest stop that we went by on the highway in Florida said 24-hour security on site. Wow. In Florida.
Because they don't... People use restaurant parking lots to fuck alligators, and they want the security there to nip that in the bud.
As long as they make it sexy, I don't care.
Gators have rights.
I used to do the 5 a.m. beer when traveling. I used to get a pint at 5 a.m., but I can't do it now, to be honest.
You're a funny guy, Carl. You sleep in bars. I've never seen anybody who sleeps in bars before.
Usually they just pass out there.
I mean, now, you know, you're considered a traveler instead of a degenerate for doing that.
Yeah, I walk between the raindrops. I you know, it's the beat of my own drum. I sleep in bars. But I got a very nice man at a comedy venue who lets me stay there because it's a pain to get back. And if I get too drunk, he's like, sleep there.
Oh, it's the same place every time?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, I thought you were like every place you went to, you would just say no.
Most people, they sometimes get let to stay in late at the old places in my hometown, but that place there is, that's just the one in Birmingham, near where Ozzy Osbourne's from, actually.
Wow!
Grab a pint and grab a booth and take a nap.
There we go, boys. I'm gonna have to jump out. Your guest is also here.
Yeah, we have good news. We don't have two no shows in one day. I was somewhat confident. I sent at least one of them the right link. Anyway, we're going to thanks for being here, Carl. We're going to play a commercial now for InVideo. InVideo is my favorite AI video creation tool. It will be yours too. Trust me, as I say in the commercial, or somebody.
He never got ahead of.
Hey there, fellow content creators. Are you tired of seeing your YouTube channel growth at a snail's pace? Well, I've got some good news for you. InVideo is here to supercharge your channel growth. With InVideo, you can create eye-catching and engaging videos in a flash. Say goodbye to spending hours editing and perfecting your content. InVideo's user-friendly interface makes it a breeze to create professional-looking videos in no time. But that's not all. InVideo offers a treasure trove of customizable templates, so you can easily tailor your videos to your unique style and brand. Stand out from the crowd and leave a lasting impression on your viewers. And the best part, InVideo is not just a video editing tool, it's a one-stop shop for all your YouTube needs. From creating thumbnails to adding subtitles, InVideo has got you covered every step of the way. So what are you waiting for? Give your YouTube channel the boost it deserves with InVideo. Join the ranks of successful content creators who have used InVideo to skyrocket their channel growth. Trust me, you won't regret it.
Trust that guy, you won't regret it. Well, you can trust me too, you won't regret it. You can take that screen out of my face. Now look, Ron has got like, that's a different background. That's like a, I don't know, weird looking brain sandwich or something. Brain sandwich he's got. I don't know what happened to the angry bear that he used to have, but I didn't even notice that. Was that there before and I just didn't notice? I was just assuming it was your bear, or did you just change the background?
I just changed the background.
All right. I'm not going crazy. All right.
No, it is a brain sandwich.
It's a brain sandwich. Believe me, I've chopped up enough brains to recognize. Well, that doesn't exactly look like a brain, but it gives the impression of a brain. I spent a lot of years slicing brain like a deli clerk slicing brains for sandwiches. I understand the whole brain slicing stuff.
Now, with all the brains that you slice, because one of the things that people used to say when I was growing up was that the more wrinkled the brain was, the more intelligent the person happened to be. Did you see?
Absolutely. Well, I never really had a conversation with somebody before I got a hold of their brain. Usually,
yeah, but that's
almost exclusively they were dead by the time I got their brain.
Because I know when people, surgeons operate on people's brains, they try to keep the person awake so that they know exactly what part of the brain they're poking. Absolutely. And what effects it's going to have. I didn't know if you were doing the same thing when you were slicing it.
No, yeah, well, I was making brain slices for research, and so they were long dead by that time. And the brain surgeons would definitely, I know some brain surgeons, and they're going to be pissed at me for saying this, but they're all the craziest fucking people on the planet, brain surgeons. Anyway, our next guest.
Like the guy that used to run HUD? The gifted hands guy? What's it?
No.
You think I would remember my newest family.
Ron, you have a sound effect for this? No. Anyway. Our guest is good. Let's move on. We're going to talk about the Constitution. You know that the Constitution, it was, I think James Madison was the main author, and there were other guys who got involved in it. My problem with Madison is when the White House was under attack, Madison ran away and left his wife in charge. That's not exactly my kind of guy. Run away and leave your wife in charge. Peter Serefine, I hope that's how you pronounce his last name, Peter Serefine. Oh, Serefine, U.S. Navy veteran, Pennsylvania State Constable, who exemplifies service, balancing roles as a U.S. mail carrier and a constitutional educator. He's here now. Let's welcome him. And don't take my spot, Peter. Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Thanks for being here.
And it was Serefine.
Serefine. Well, I apologize for that. You know, we didn't get a chance to say hello before the program, but I on my evening program, I always make sure I get to figure out how to pronounce the people's name. And here it's always a crap shoot. Now, I apologize for getting it wrong, but I won't get it wrong again unless I get it wrong again, and then I'll say I'm sorry again. So the Constitution, written in 1787, I kind of brought this up this morning. It was an attempt, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong. This is my my understanding of it. We had the Articles of Confederation, which was not strong enough of a central government. So the Constitution was an attempt to give us a stronger central federal government. But most of the constitutionalists I talked to today are for a smaller government. That makes no sense to me. First of all, let's start with, am I correct in that the Articles of Confederation were seen as too weak of a central government, so we needed a constitution to have a stronger central federal government?
Yes. In the 1780s, there was all kinds of rebellion going on in our country, with like literal armed rebellions, you know, Shays Rebellion, for example. And the federal government really couldn't do anything about it. Like, there was clearly unrest in our nation. The federal government had no power to tax. They had no power to raise income other than to ask the states for money. And the states often said, no. So
yeah, most people have no idea about that. I don't know if we were taught that in school, or we just weren't, like, we were smoking pot and didn't really care or any of that stuff. But most people are totally unaware of what you just said.
Yeah. So they got together and they were supposed to fix the Articles of Confederation, but the Articles of Confederation required a unanimous approval in order to change anything. And I mean, the four of us probably couldn't agree unanimously on anything. Like, getting 13 states to agree unanimously on any change.
I think we unanimously agree on that. The four of us cannot unanimously agree on anything.
So pretty so early on, the people at that Second Continental Congress said, you know, we can't fix this. So right. Why don't we come up with something new? And a lot of people refer to it as a runaway convention because they did more than they were supposed to do. But what they did is they drafted this constitution, and nobody was bound by it until at least 9 states ratified it.
Right.
It wasn't in effect. And it was we
the people. How many states were there at the time? Was it 13, or had it expanded by that time?
It was still 13, and 9 had to ratify it before anybody was bound by it. And only the first 9 that ratified it would be bound. The other 4 would, you know, still live under the articles. The Constitution was ratified by we the people. Like, it went to conventions in individual states to be ratified by citizens, not, you know, the
right leadership. At that time, the legislative branch was really in charge of the government, right? The executive branch was kind of just like a puppet thing, and the judicial branch kind of really didn't exist. Or am I wrong about that?
Yeah, that's pretty simplified way of looking at it, but pretty accurate too. Yeah. The executive branch at the time, they didn't have a president. There wasn't an executive branch as we know it today under the Articles of Confederation. And it was a unicameral legislature, meaning one house. So they all had to agree to do anything. And
I think most people, I bet you if we test the audience right now, they probably think that George Washington took over the minute that the British left you know, 79 or whatever it was. But Washington didn't become president until 1789, right? Is that correct?
Yes.
Or I think
1789.
Most people are under the impression that we won and then we elected George Washington like the next day.
nothing like that at all. George Washington had gone back to Virginia, was planting again, and the Second Continental Congress was over and the Constitution was ratified and they decided, hey, we need a president. Everybody knew it was going to be George Washington, but George. Right. You know, he had gone back to farming. So a representative went and said, hey, we want you to be president. And he's like, all right, well, I'll do it, but I don't want paid for it. Just like everything else. He never took a salary for being, you know, commanding general of the army. So he didn't want to take a salary for being president either. And they made him. They're like, nope, sorry, you have to take it.
Because there's going to be people after you and we don't want to pay them.
Yeah. I would love to have a president who really doesn't want the job, who takes it reluctantly because public insists on. Like, I don't want the job. Right now, we see, I think we see too many people just lust after the power and all that kind of stuff. And I've said for years, nobody really who would be great in that job wants to do that job.
Right.
We get all the wrong people who want to do that job.
George had this incredible sense of what was known at the time was noblesse oblige, the obligation of the wealthy. If you had money, you were obligated to do certain things for your society. So whenever he was called upon to do something, he felt, you know, internally obligated to do it because he had been so blessed throughout life.
Wow. Now the Bill of Rights was really the first 10 amendments, right? So of the Constitution. So the Constitution was built as something that, and again, correct me if I'm wrong on this. These are my perceptions. The Constitution was created as something that was supposed to be amendable and changeable, not a document that was, you know, 300 years from now or 240 years from now, whatever we are, we're 240 years from there, 235, whatever it is. It wasn't supposed to be set in stone that 240 years from now, it'll still be the exact same words are really, you know, the bedrock of how we govern. Or do you agree with that? Am I right about that?
Well, it was definitely designed to be amendable, and we've amended it 27 times.
27 times.
And the amendment process was intentionally made difficult. The federal government was designed to be slow moving. They were not supposed to act on, you know, the whims of the day. They were supposed to be deliberate, slow moving, and do very little, to be honest with you. If you read the Constitution, there's 17 things that Congress is supposed to do, and they're not supposed to do anything but those 17 things. Now,
let me just say that, because if to some effect, they have been true to that, because there have been 1,100 attempts to add amendments, only 27. So that's a pretty consistent with what you just said. It's hard to amend.
What's really funny is about the Bill of Rights in particular is a lot of people think the First Amendment is first because it's the most important. And arguably it may be the most important, but it was not first. It was third in the list. So Madison drafted, I believe it was 15, a potential amendments. He gave them to Congress, and Congress cut it down to 12. Congress cut it down to 12, sent it down to the states, and the states ratified 10 of the 12. And then what was originally the First Amendment did not get ratified until 1994.
The 27th
Amendment was originally first in the list of amendments of the Bill of Rights. And it was found by some grad student, and he was like, wow, this one, you know, never got ratified by enough states. And he took it as a project, and he actually got a bad grade on his project in school about trying to get this thing ratified. So he was like, F you, teacher, I'm going to show you how it's done. And he ran out and got more states to ratify that 27th Amendment until it got enough ratification.
And I got to read what it actually says. Maybe
Congress can't give themselves raises that take effect within the same term. So if Congress votes a raise for themselves, right, it doesn't take effect until the following election.
I knew it had to do with congressional compensation, but it doesn't address what I think is the real problem with congressional compensation is the insider trading the insider knowledge about what you can, you know, all those kind of things. I mean, salary is one thing, but nobody's getting rich on $140,000 or whatever the congressional salary is right now. Nobody's getting super wealthy on that every year. They're getting rich on their investments and their lobbying money and all that, the sneaky under the table deals that they're doing. And the amendment obviously does, maybe it does, and it's not being enforced, but that's the most important thing. Yes or no?
It is the most important thing. And there needs to be something done about it, but guess who has to pass that law?
Right. Yeah, Congress. You're asking me to.
Well, can I read my own pay? I know this one.
if you look at, it's really funny. If you look at like, what's his name? Warren Buffett, probably the best stock trader ever. He gets like, I don't know, between 4% and 7% return on his investments on average. Whereas most of Congress gets 7% to 10% return on their investments on average. So here's like the best stock trader in the world.
And I think
everybody in Congress is doing better than him.
Hillary Clinton was the best stock trader in the world. From what I remember, I think she put $1,000 in and became $100,000 in 6 weeks or 13 weeks, something like that.
Funny how, you know, Congress people buy some, you know, abandoned building in some city, and then 3 weeks later, there's a giant government contract to do something with that building. I'm like, gee, I wonder how that happened.
Yeah. Now I have looked at a little bit of your TikTok stuff, and I get the impression, well, I'm pretty sure that you are a strong Second Amendment defender, and I encouraged by the fact that you're sponsored by somebody who insures gun owners.
Yeah, right to bear.
We've talked about that being an important part of responsible gun ownership, but it doesn't seem to be doing the trick. Because it's not mandatory, right? People who own guns are not mandated to have insurance on their guns at this point. No. But I do think that would go a long way, and I think GD has expressed this too, and correct me if I'm wrong, go a long way to stop like irresponsible gun ownership where, you know, your mentally retarded kid has just got a hold of your AK-47 or whatever, that kind of stuff. So, but the question I have, is that ever going to be enforceable or acceptable to Second Amendment people that it would be mandated to have insurance on something?
No, and let's go back to the Bill of Rights, First Amendment, Second Amendment, the difference in the verbiage of those two amendments. The First Amendment says, or it starts with, Congress shall make no law respecting freedom of speech and religion and all that kind of stuff. So it starts with Congress shall make no law, meaning that the federal government can't abridge your freedoms of speech or religion or assembly.
But the Supreme Court can.
Well, when it was written, states still could. So when the First Amendment was ratified in 1791, states still had state religions. I believe three of the states still had, you know, official state religions. They had blasphemy laws. They had profanity laws. There were all kinds of things that we would consider unconstitutional today. But the First Amendment didn't apply to the states, or wasn't supposed to apply to the states. It was only to apply to the federal government. Now, the Second Amendment, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, shall not be infringed. Doesn't say shall not be infringed by Congress. Meaning, the states couldn't do it either. The way it was written, but no.
But didn't it say well-regulated, though?
Yeah, it says, well, a well-regulated militia is necessary for the security of a free state.
But who would regulate if you don't? I mean, who's going to regulate it? The neighbors?
But what did regulation mean in 1791 versus we hear the word regulation and we think government control. We think rules and government control and you know, laws is basically what we think when we hear the word regulate. But in 1791, the word regulate meant to keep regular. To keep it moving, to keep it flowing, to keep it doing whatever it is it's doing. And if you ever have a question about the meaning of a word in the Constitution, look up that word in Webster's 1828 dictionary. There's a free app you can put on your phone for it. Webster's 1828 dictionary, written by Daniel Webster, one of the founding fathers, because he did not want us to lose the language that was used then. He knew that the meaning of words change. So he wrote a dictionary specifically so that we would always be able to look back and know what the founding fathers meant when they wrote what they wrote.
All right, let me stop you there. Can you look up arms and what that meant to them? Because I'm sure it did not mean atomic weapons. I'm sure it did not mean having an anthrax lab or biological weapons, right? Or...
but it also,
yeah, because that it,
go ahead.
I was just going to say, kind of reiterate what Matt said, is like, especially with the Second Amendment, like the intention is there and it's good, but two, they didn't foresee weapons and weapons advancements. And I mean, the perfect example I always use is that so many people have cell phones, and you see how many people cannot even handle a cell phone. Mm-hmm. So you're telling me these people should own a gun as well? Probably no. Not. Yeah,
there's nothing about responsibility in there. That's a big problem. But I do come back to this idea of what they meant by arms, because that is, and the other part of it, and I don't want to get too contrived here, but can the Second Amendment be revised or updated to reflect today's society? But let's start with the arms, because they meant musket. I'm thinking they purposely didn't write guns, because they meant more than just guns. But they certainly were not aware of space lasers or atomic weapons or biological weapons or cyber warfare weapons. All these kind of stuff, rocket propelled grenades. They weren't aware of this, so they wrote arms. What did it mean to them, arms?
Arms in Webster's 1828 dictionary says weapons of offense or armor for defense and protection of the body. Huh. So it was offensive or defensive weapons.
So by that, if I had a anthrax lab going on, that would be okay.
Yeah, if you go back to their original intent. However, right, that's why there's an amendment process. Should the Second right. Amendment have been amended at some point in the last 245 years? Probably. There probably yeah, should have been some limit added to it. But that's not how our government did it. They didn't change the right given to us, you know, by God and sanctified in the Constitution. They just ignored it and passed a whole bunch of laws.
Right.
But I think quite often that I think that because there's so much money involved in these things, like guns or arms are manufactured by corporations, you know, yeah, who make money off of this. So you give enough money to the right people in government, nothing's going to move.
Right. And that's the big part of the problem with government. But that's not how, in particular, with arms, with the Second Amendment, I don't think it is corporations that are the biggest problem. Because if I go into my basement and I take a piece of pipe and I make a rifle, which you can do, everything you need to make a rifle, you can buy at Lowe's.
Or you could buy a 3D printer and get an effective plastic an undetect. Why am I even saying this in public?
But you can
get around the law. Yeah.
You go to your local hardware store. You buy a piece of half inch pipe, and oh look, half inch pipe. That's 50 caliber. So you can shoot a 50 caliber through a piece of half inch pipe. So right. Now all you need is a striker to hit the bullet at the end. But that's illegal. Making a rifle is illegal without a license from the federal government. So right. the entire idea that we have a God-given and constitutionally protected right to own firearms is gone in this country. Because if it was right. a God-given right that was protected by the Constitution, there wouldn't be 6,000 gun laws in the country.
Can we not say God-given right in Constitution, since I don't think God wrote the Constitution?
No, that's not what I'm referring to. What I'm referring to is the Declaration of Independence that says our rights come from God.
Yeah, they screwed that up too.
The Constitution then lists out, hey, these are some of those rights.
Right, right. Now, because the language itself is specific, and I think it was written intentionally, you know, and that, and what is specific in those times, there is no mention of responsibility in it. And I had an Army guy on Wednesday night, Tuesday night, whatever, and we were talking about, because he's a big Second Amendment guy, and I said, you know, there's no responsibility, and even if there were responsibility language in there, it'd be impossible to enforce responsibility. So that's my biggest problem with gun ownership, is there are too many people who take it lightly, are irresponsible adults, and you know, don't keep it locked up properly or allow access. Because when I was 13 years old, a friend of mine who is still a huge Second Amendment guy, and we have this argument all the time, is he believes he's a responsible gun owner. I said, when I was 13 years old, I was able to go into your father's room, take his 22 pistol, and shoot out the neighbors. And I got caught for this, and I didn't kill anybody. But I was able to get his gun and shoot it at a 13-year-old, unsupervised, not just your own child getting into your gun, but your child's friend. That's pretty irresponsible. And there's no way that we can ever, like, truly enforce responsibility, or is there, in your view?
Well, no, that's society. I mean, just looking back, the society of the 18th century versus the society of today,
right?
People just had a sense of responsibility back then.
They right. Now, I was saying, just recently, the two parents of Ethan Crumbly just got sentenced to 10 to 15 years. It was Jennifer and James Crumbly. Maybe over time, people seeing those kinds of things, they will start to say, okay, wow, they got sentenced. Of course, that's just Michigan. Every state is going to be a little different, but they'll start seeing the picture like, hey, okay, I can be held responsible for when my kid does really stupid shit with my gun.
Yeah, and that's one way that we might be able to shall we say, encourage responsible gun ownership.
Right.
Yeah, encourage it, but there's no way to really enforce it, because you can't have government agents going on knocking on doors and saying, where's your gun? Where do you keep it locked up? Who gets access to it? You know,
I mean, I think it's Hawaii who just recently passed what they call safe storage laws, and Biden wants safe storage laws everywhere. These safe storage laws require, like, you know, your ammunition and your firearms to be stored in separate locations, or your firearm to have a trigger lock and be locked inside of a safe. And, you know, like,
well, for the purposes of protection, that totally negates the idea of using it. Yeah, yeah,
right.
You can't.
Right. So let's say that I live in Pennsylvania. I keep a handgun in a quick access safe next to my bed. So, you know, I wake up in the middle of the night, somebody in my house, I push a couple of buttons, it flops open. I've got a loaded handgun in my hand within 2 seconds. And it's locked, so nobody can just walk in and take it.
Right.
But if I'm living, if you know, Governor Shapiro here signs a bill that requires that my firearm and my ammunition both be locked up in separate locations, I'm dead by the home invader by the time I can load my firearm.
But they have to define location, so it could just be the other drawer.
I just learned that Ben Shapiro is the governor of Pennsylvania. I just learned
it. It's Josh Shapiro. I'd rather have Ben Shapiro as governor.
Let's talk a little bit about, because I'm not sure Trust Shattered is the book that's behind you.
Yep.
Is that the book that you mention in one of your reels about being acknowledged, and forgive me, my brain is Swiss cheese, but somebody acknowledged it as one of the 50 top political books ever written? Is that?
No, Trust Shattered hasn't even come out yet. It comes out on May 1st.
Okay.
The one that you're referring to, Book Authority named one of my books one of the best politician books of all times. And it was called So Simple Even a Politician Can Understand. Simple ideas for seemingly complex political issues. So yeah, that's the first
time I've ever won an award. Give you any Did Geico give you any crap about the title?
No.
I don't know who's dumber, a politician or a caveman. We'll get to the bottom of that.
Well, so congratulations on that. That's money.
That's an honor.
It is. I was thrilled.
Yeah. No, I mean, just to be on the top in any category is a general honor. Now, Trust Shattered, that comes out May 1st. Give us a breakdown of what it's about. Obviously, the title kind of suggestive enough that we could kind of guess, but tell us what it would.
Oh, Trust Shattered chronicles about 45 examples of where our government has betrayed its duty to protect our life, liberty, and property. 45 examples of things that they've admitted to, things that are provable. There are no conspiracy theories in this book. I went out of my way to make sure that nothing in here is conspiracy theory. I even removed the conspiracy theory section from other stories that they've admitted. And the idea is, so I take these 45 examples, I divide them up into John Locke's categories of life, liberty, and property. So there's three parts to the book. Part one is called Betrayed Bodies. And it is, you know, human trials and human experimentation and stuff like that, that our government's admitted to. The most famous of which is probably the Tuskegee syphilis experiments. And that's one where I, you know, the official narrative is that the government went out and found 600 men in Tuskegee, Alabama, who had syphilis, 600 black men who had syphilis, and then studied them for 40 years. The conspiracy part of it is some people think that, no, the government went out and found 600 black men in Tuskegee, Alabama, and gave them syphilis. Now, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know if that's true or not. So I didn't include.
I don't think you have to with black folks. I think they all have it anyway. Don't they all have it anyway?
It's like, yeah, it's a trait. It's a trait. It's like a sickle cell.
Yeah, I was going to say it's like a sickle cell thing, right?
Yeah. It's a
trait. So that's probably the most famous thing in Betrayed Bodies, the first part of the book. I personally think the most egregious thing that I chronicle in that part of the book is the San Francisco biological warfare experiments, where the federal government, the mostly the military, just sprayed bacteria over San Francisco just to see how it would spread. 750,000 people lived in San Francisco at a time. None of them knew it was happening. The federal government just did it.
I would think if somebody did know what was happening, they'd get out of Dodge, basically.
Yeah, you would
think. They would have been there.
Our government, though. Sorry, I was just going to say, our government does. I mean, they've always had a history. I mean, it's for any president too, no matter Democrat or Republican, each one has blood on their hands in some aspect because of something they screwed up or ordered. And it's like the CIA is known as one of, you know, the world's largest drug dealer. They know how to move drugs. So and you got this "Don't Say No" campaign. It's ridiculous.
Well, that explains a lot. I have two cousins who are CIA, and I swore that I could never get in the CIA because I said my family just has a checkered past.
My family has a more, and my family name has a more checkered. I would venture to say that my family name has a more checkered past. Beyond checkered, it's disgusting, but I had no problem getting into it. My security clearance took 35 minutes to get with the CIA. So,
I was just saying, so I assumed that I could never get in, but when my cousins got in, and their brother was literally one of the three main drug distributors, illegal drug distributors in the state of Maryland, and they got in.
Yeah.
And so I talked to a friend of mine who was an attaché.
They have no problem dealing with people,
right?
With criminal
he
history.
Goes, no, they love that. Yeah. They know you can be. They know what you, you know, how they can manipulate you.
Right. Mm-hmm. But Peter, now on this conspiracy theory thing, you mentioned all the things that we know the government has admitted to, but I think, how do I even express this? I think the things that they don't admit to leave a hole and created this whole world of conspiracy theories. Mm-hmm. Now, I hate when people just imagine. Like, I'm laying in bed and I get this idea about what might happen. And if I think and ruminate on it enough, I can connect dots and become an expert in it in my own mind, and then go on social media and start to spread it, connecting these dots that I imagined. And then before you know it, it's all around the world. And one of the things that I think is the core of this in modern society, and you can probably go back before this, but the Kennedy thing, I think you would agree that Joe Biden and Donald Trump are on opposite spectrums of the political field, but both of them were obligated to release JFK's files and refused to. And that just you know, that just leaves everybody grasping and making up new stories all the time. That stuff that they don't tell us.
Yeah, is they just more keep throwing more gas somewhere on the conspiracy fire. Exactly.
Yeah.
And what's really funny is if you look through the 45 examples in here, you know, a lot of them were conspiracy theories for, you know, 20 years or so. It seems about 20 years after when we normally find out about something that the government has been doing.
All right, talk to me about this, because how accurate, because I understand and I totally agree with you that at some point all of them had people talking about them in conspiratorial terms, but how accurate were the conspiracy? Because I think a lot of it is people get a hint of, oh, something doesn't add up and it smells funny, and then they start adding details that they make up in their mind, and that becomes part of it. So just because it was a conspiracy theory doesn't mean it was accurate to the, and even just because they admit it doesn't mean that they're telling us the accurate final truth on it.
Well, I mean, you know, the example of the Tuskegee syphilis experience, they've admitted that they studied these 600 men. The conspiracy says that they gave them the syphilis, but they've never admitted that. So maybe they did, maybe they didn't. I wasn't around in 1923 when it started. But there's a lot.
I just want to ask you a personal question real quick. Yeah. I love the sound of your voice.
Well, thank you.
It's like, is that your real voice? I mean, do you order off a menu like that? Is that how you talk to
No, that's my regular voice. This is my regular voice.
I was just saying, because I can just see the waiters just you ordering.
My radio voice is a little more like this, but
I can just see you ordering something off the menu and the waitress doesn't even move. She just stares at you going like, wow, say that again.
It's really funny is when I was in high school, I worked at Wendy's, and I'm old. This is back before they had the headsets, and there was like a button that you had to push and you spoke through. And if you were old enough to remember, like the drive through, like nobody could ever understand anybody. Terrible back then. And I had customers on a regular basis that would come to the window and be like, you should be on the radio. And like 40 years later, I started a podcast. You know?
Good. So it took a while for it to sink in.
Yeah. With the premise of trust shattered, it's a two-part question. Trust is important. I think you would agree that Americans trusting their government is somewhat important. We don't, because trust has been shattered. Can it ever be repaired in your view? Because in my, I will come right in and give you my view that no, it can't. Can we ever repair the damage that has been done, or have the lies upon lies been stacked too high and deep for us to ever really feel like?
Well, throughout the book, I give a hint here and there of ways that government could regain our trust, but there are things like, you know, they've got to come clean and be honest, like release the Kennedy files. Anybody involved is long dead. Who's going to get hurt? So the
Ted Cruz's father is still around, isn't he?
Well, just you asking that question raises a lot of suspicions in my mind. Like, yes, I agree that everybody must be dead. So if it's like abundantly apparent that everybody is dead and who could be hurt, what the hell could be so bad that they're afraid of releasing this stuff? You know, 60 years later,
it's something that makes the government itself looks bad, not just
Kennedy's wounds were self-inflicted. That's what it is. That's what they didn't want us to know, that Kennedy's wounds were self-inflicted.
Yeah, or the Kennedy family would sue the federal government.
Yeah. That's or Jacqueline was behind it. She did it.
Yeah,
or maybe Robert F. Kennedy Jr. I really miss my uncle. I really miss him so much. But guess what?
I don't want to stay on the Kennedy thing, but last week I watched, my wife walked in on me watching.
You make it sound stupid.
Watching a documentary on JFK. She's like, that again? Like, haven't you had enough of that? And I was like, well, there's always one more that you haven't heard. And this one was that.
On me while I was watching a Kennedy
this
conspiracy.
One was that Kennedy faked his death. Kennedy faked his death. It was by a former physical effects guy from the movies. And when you see him doing this right before he's putting a squib on, and faking his death. And it was a 2-hour movie where the guy went into like extreme detail about his theory about Kennedy faking his death, Jacqueline going along with it. Aristotle Onassis was a part of the whole thing, hiding out Kennedy afterwards, and tapes of LBJ and Jackie talking 10 days after the movie, like flirtatious and all this kind of stuff, and giggling like, we got away with it, we really pulled it off and all that. So, you know, the more they dig up this kind of stuff, you if you want to, you could get on that train and start to believe it. They make all of them sound so easy for somebody who.
Well, to be honest, LBJ was known for his Johnson, which is probably why they were joking and flirting. I mean, that's exactly why his last name was not Johnson. They made him take that name.
I heard a little ladybird tell me
he
that.
He called it Jumbo.
Have you ever heard the LBJ tape where he's talking to his tailor about his pants?
And
he's talking about, you got to loosen up the crotch more. It's make right up on my balls.
Well, I mean, he was a horrible, horrible human being. He whipped it out
for a Texan.
He whipped it out and laid it on the table at a press conference once because he didn't like the question that was being asked. And it was like, well, here, ask Jumbo.
Wow. We don't have that on tape, do we?
Horrible human being. There was story. He peed on his chauffeur just because he could. He, you know, they were like standing outside peeing on his chauffeur and then told him, as long as I'm the president and you're a
peon
word.
Yeah.
I can do it whenever I want. Like, he was a horrible person.
Right. Which N-word? I'm not sure. Could you? Because I have trouble imagining that Lyndon Johnson even knew what a ninja was.
Yeah. Well, he might not have known what a ninja was, but he knew what the other N-word was. He used that New word Yorker. A lot.
New Yorker. He wasn't fond of New Yorkers.
When he signed the Bill of the Civil Rights Act. Right. The Civil Rights Act passed by a Republican Congress. The Democrat president, LBJ, when he signed it, he said this will have them enters voting Democrat for the next 100 years.
Matt, right. I just need to correct something real quick. You said New Yorker with that hard ER, and it's New Yorker. Okay.
I wouldn't know. I've never been there. Now, because those are different times. Now, LBJ had a political motive in doing that stuff, but there were, even because I'm thinking about that period, and you look old enough. I'm sorry to say that, say it in that way, but you look old enough to kind of have a memory of the late '60s or mid '60s and late '60s, perhaps maybe a little younger than that. But I have a very vivid memory of it, and it was pretty rotten times as far as a dystopian outlook, race riots and hippies and shootings on campus and all that stuff, assassinations. And we were, you know, dystopian minded then, but now almost everybody is, dystopia is a word on, like, there are 1,000 dystopia podcasts and political people use the word dystopia at all times. With history, you're being a history buff and own, do you feel like we are on in something new, or is this cyclical, this idea of things are beyond repair and we're too divided to ever come together as a country again?
Oh, I definitely think it's cyclical. And anytime somebody says that, you know, we've never been this divided before, I go back to, oh, really? Have you ever read any of the accounts of Congress just before the Civil War? I can't remember, a representative went from the House of Representatives and walked across the Capitol building to the Senate side or vice versa and literally beat somebody with a cane, like, on the floor, like almost killed him.
Back when canes meant something.
Yeah.
Yeah. We almost had that in the Senate with the guy from Oklahoma who wanted to beat up the union boss.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that wasn't I'm going to puff up my chest and say some stuff. This was literally beat a guy almost to death in the Capitol building.
Yeah.
Like, wow.
You know, we had Aaron Burr and Hamilton, like, literally duel. Like, so yeah, we're it's not good. We're horribly politically divided, but it has been worse. So I don't like hyperbole.
Or as bad. I don't know. Worse, it's been as bad many times, I think.
I would say it's worse just for the simple fact of how information is spread, especially with the internet and groups like that. Because before, you know, you didn't have the opportunity to really express your thoughts except to your neighbors. But now anyone can
Everybody
do it.
Everybody is Walter Cronkite with breaking news. And and it's not necessarily ever true. It's not necessarily ever true news.
Getting the news out is more important than getting it right before you put it out. And then, of course, hardly anybody ever corrects it when they realize they have it wrong.
Yeah. Oh, I got to think about it, Gov. Thanks for reminding me, GD. You got one job and you didn't do it.
I watched you turn off the alarm. So I
know, but
you
he was saying something interesting, and I was concentrating on what he's saying. I was just turning off the alarm.
So you listen to the guest say something interesting, but if I try to say something interesting, you don't even listen to me.
In the chat room, can you refresh my mind when GD has said something interesting?
To circle back to the book for a second, my view of government is what was written out by Thomas Jefferson in the Declaration of Independence. And I believe that the purpose of government is to protect our rights. You know, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. That to protect these rights, governments are instituted among men. So I believe that the primary purpose of government is to protect our rights. The book Trust Shattered is basically me illustrating examples of why, when they did not do that, and then trying to write it in such a way that if you're on my side of the political aisle and you're skeptical of government, you can read it and you might learn a thing or two about it. And you know, examples, things.
What if you're on the other side of the political aisle?
I tried to write it in a way that it was not offensive, so that you, after you read it, can hand it to your most progressive cousin or sister-in-law or neighbor or whatever.
GD's wife, yes. Who is to the left of, yes. Who is she to the left of?
My wife is, if you take Tom Hartman and make a left, you hit Rachel Maddow. Make a left after Rachel Maddow, you hit my wife.
Wow.
But then I have to say something.
I would never hit your wife. I just want to say I would never
hit my wife. Because then I have to puff up.
The idea of it is I want somebody, let's say your wife, I would assume that she believes in universal health care.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So after looking at all of the stuff,
the universe should have health care.
Right. If the government is responsible for forcibly sterilizing people for 80 years, the Tuskegee syphilis experiments, when they studied these 600 guys, even for 50 years after there was a known cure, the polio vaccine, when they said, oh, I'm sorry, Cutter Industries, I know that there's live polio in those vaccines, send it out anyway, and gave 150 kids polio knowingly. Project 112, Project Shad, the San Francisco Bond.
That's because they're not responsible for healthcare. They were just they were just irresponsible.
Right.
But if you make them responsible for healthcare, if it becomes like a mandate, then they can't do that, right? Because it's a mandate. You can't break a mandate.
Really? I'm pretty sure there's a mandate that they're supposed to protect our lives, and they did all of these things.
Right. So they also had to, when they defined life, I'm pretty sure that some people weren't included in life.
But the issue I have with that is, if you look at Europe and industrialized nations, those countries do not have great backgrounds with those with their people either. And they do have universal health care. And there was a book written a few years ago, I forget the guy's name, but he actually, his whole thing was he looked at every single piece, every country that had universal health care in some aspect, or whether they did not. And what he really found is that people complain no matter what. If the government's doing it, it's terrible. But then if the government's not doing it, it's terrible, because then it's completely owned by private companies. And like healthcare in this country, especially when you look at other industrialized nations, it's a joke. We're a joke.
Yeah, I don't want to go crazy on this particular issue, but I think the government is responsible for letting the insurance companies and the and capitalism within the insurance companies run amok and unchecked. And that is what creates the desire for a universal healthcare system. But how do we trust the people? Like to Peter's point, they've fucked this over so many times that how do you trust those people? And if you can't trust them to keep the John D. Rockefellers who run the current insurance companies, who just kind of want to write the healthcare bill, they had a huge say in Obamacare. You can't trust them, keep the government to keep those people, the corrupt people, out of writing the bills.
We cap how much personal wealth they're allowed to have and remain in office. If they exceed that, then they can no longer be in office. So that way, at least people will come in and say, oh, I can only be worth $800,000. Once I get that, I'm out.
That's another problem. We want simple solutions where there are no simple solutions. And I think going back to Peter's original point.
I disagree. There are some simple solutions. So simple, even a politician can understand.
All right. Well, I appreciate that. But back to your original point, is a big part of it is we can't coming together on this stuff. Like Peter said, us coming to a unanimous agreement on anything is very, it's limited to whether we can come to a unanimous agreement on anything, really, basically. So it's trying to get both sides to work together for the people is. Yeah, and it requires some degree of trust, and that trust has been shattered. So this has been a very good conversation. The book comes out May 1st, liberty-lighthouse.com. You also have a podcast and TikTok channel and YouTube channel and all that kind of stuff going on, right?
Yeah, I got all that stuff. I actually gave up the radio show about 4 or 5 months ago, the podcast, and to focus on writing. So now I'm focusing on a weekly article on Substack. It's libertylighthouse.substack.com, and then the books. So I gave up the radio show to focus on writing. Trust Shattered has its own website. It's trustshattered.com. You can pre-order the book there, and if you pre-order it within the next let's say 5 days, I will send an indexed copy of the U.S. Constitution along with it, where you can go open up to the back and look up something, for example, habeas corpus. Well, that's in Article 1, Section 9, Clause 2. And then where
to look. I could just spend $60 on a Trump Bible and get a copy of the Constitution. I don't understand. I'm just kidding.
Well, this will be, but was the one he gave you indexed like mine?
Well, I think in his, all of the Jesus quotes have been replaced with Trump said. Trump. I'm not certain.
DJP.
And there's a nice centerfold of a tasteful nude of Jesus in the middle,
Oh, wow.
Trump's tasteful. Red.
Tasteful is the most important.
Now, Peter, I do have a serious question for you, Peter. Is that website there listed, is that a way for people to get, I'm trying to get a hold of you directly.
You can go to liberty-lighthouse.com. That's kind
I'll
of my
send home page. You his email.
That you go to
all
that.
What you have to do is ask.
I trust you, Matt. You used to work for the CIA. How do I know that you were sending his actual email?
Well, he got the link, Peter, right there. Right
yeah, but you were trying to get him on the air. You were probably trying to stop me from talking to him and not give me that. I will use the email you send me, and I'll wind up on some porn site, and I can't get out until I finish.
Well, I need to regain your trust by telling you I killed Kennedy.
Thank God. Which one?
All of them.
There's one more Kennedy left. He's John Kennedy. He's a senator.
I've been told by his family he's not really a Kennedy. We have to let Peter go. Peter, thank you for this conversation. GD, I will put you in touch with him. All you have to do is ask. Thank you for being part of it. It's been a really nice cool segment. I appreciated talking to you. I'm sure there's lots more we could talk about. If you're so inclined and want to come back on around the time the book is released to help promote it, I would love to have you back. So
sure.
Thanks, Sarah.
Don't change your voice, because otherwise
I
won't
listen. He just did a little Jordan Peterson. Sure. Sure. Anyway,
that's his real voice. That's how. That's now we got it.
Yeah.
Got
all right, Peter. Bye for now. Have a great day, and thanks for being here.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
All right, bye. Pretty cool stuff there. You know what? It's good that, because I know he's to the right, and you guys are both to the left, and me, I don't know where I am. I'm like hovering. But it's good to see we can have a civil conversation about these issues without yelling at each other or all that kind of stuff.
The last guy that got on the thing with us?
Well, that guy was not, I don't know if he was to the right or, I think he was to his own kind of veered off right. The guy who was rewriting, what was he rewriting? He was rewriting something, not the Constitution. Right. No, he was rewriting. I forget what he was rewriting.
Basically, he was trying to get rid of Washington, D.C. He really just wanted to get rid of Washington, D.C. and the Congress and the building.
And make everything a museum. Like the Smithsonian was going to take over the White House and the Senate.
Right.
I forget what he was, what his basic premise was. But I know we were all yelling at him and kind of disagreeing with, but that guy seemed like clueless. He didn't have the education that Peter seemed to have a very well.
I didn't ask him what a constable does.
What?
What a constable does.
Oh. Well. I'm sorry. Hey, you know what? You're there. You got a mouth for me to shut you up.
No, I was going to ask him that, and then something else came up, and I didn't write it down, so I didn't think about it again.
Yeah, believe me, it happens to every show, like 10 times a show with me. You want to do Critical Joke Theory and then we'll come back and wrap things up?
Sure. Yeah, that'd be like groovy.
I forgot to play the news today too.
I was going to ask you about that, but I thought you might smite me.
No, I might. Well, you know what? I really am obligated to do the news because we're trying to pitch this thing. You know, I'm explaining to you over there in the chat room that we have to do the news in order to get like syndicated on terrestrial radio. You're going to have to bear with us. We're going to get like 4 minutes of news every show. I'm hiccuping from a lack of coffee. So you do Critical Joke Theory. I will take a nap. Yeah, like I always do.
Okay. Excuse me, cool.
Hiccup. And then I'll go get a fresh coffee and maybe stop hiccuping. Take it away.
Watch. Hello, welcome to Critical Joke Theory with your host, G.D. Fenderson, certified forensic humorist. Now with new joke technology.
Damn it, baby. Hi, I'm G.D. Fenderson, certified forensic humorist at large, but I'm losing weight. Welcome to Critical Joke Theory. Episode 51, now with new joke technology, an open caption for the humor impaired. Here we go. The Juice, Orenthal James Simpson, the former American football star, actor, and notorious suspected double murderer, has died of cancer at 76. His family said in a statement on Thursday, his 1995 trial and controversial acquittal for the deaths of his ex-wife, Nicole Brown Simpson, and her friend, Ronald Goldman, provided one of the world's most watched popular cultural events of the last century. O.J. Simpson, seen here saying, "Oh, those dead bodies," was a phenomenal running back and made people laugh in his role as Detective Nordberg in the Nicky Gunn trilogy. He ran through airports for Hertz before running from the law to avoid being hurt. Oh well, OJ, the Juice has reached its expiration date. A retired chiropractor, next one. Damn it. There we go. A retired chiropractor who just moved my teleprompter up one slot and I can't see the rest of the, there we go. A retired chiropractor from upstate New York allegedly killed an Elvis impersonator by chloroforming him during a sexual encounter. Ronald G. Raher, 69, bound and restrained the impersonator, Thomas Kreider, 40, on April 5th, before dosing him with the dangerous, heavily regulated anesthetic chloroform more than one time, according to court documents cited in the Times Union. Authorities hit him with charges of second-degree manslaughter and evidence tampering for allegedly removing Kreider's personal things from the crime scene, the Times Union said. Sheriff's deputies were trying to figure out where Rare got the chloroform. The retiree, and Kreider, who worked under the stage name TJ Green, had known each other for many years, and both the sexual encounter and the chloroform use appeared to be consensual. The undersheriff said, "Drug me tender, I'll fall asleep on your basement floor." Five people have been arrested, including one minor, after a shooting Wednesday between two rival groups at a Muslim religious celebration in West Philadelphia, leaving at least three people injured and many families scrambling for safety, authorities said. The shooting happened during an event for Eid al-Fitr, an Islamic holiday to commemorate the end of the month of fasting.
Ari Shafir?
That's right. The shots, yeah, he did were fired. The shots were fired on the west side of the city near the Philadelphia Masjid Mosque at around 2:30 p.m. shortly before festivities that began in the morning were set to conclude, according to the mosque website. Firearms and fasting just don't mix. Next time, just eat something. A sandwich, a taco,
Snickers,
a stop, anything.
A Snickers.
Ham, salami, bacon.
Because you're not yourself when you're hungry.
Damn, I wish I thought of that one. Three mariners who were stranded on a tiny island in the Pacific were rescued.
This feels like a Gilligan's Island episode. I'm sorry.
I know. I did not reference Gilligan Island on purpose. Three mariners who were stranded on a tiny island in the Pacific were, specific as some of my people say, were rescued after they spelled out help with palm leaves on the beach. The Coast Guard said Tuesday, marking the second time in 4 years that castaways were found on the same island. The sailors were found on Pikelot Atoll after being stuck in the Micronesian archipelago for over a week. Pikelot is the Polynesian word for broke back. The three men survived on coconuts. Now that everyone knows where this island is, they have to find another hookup spot.
And the professor made radios out of those coconuts.
Former Trump CFO Alan Weisenberg has been... That's not Weisenberg. I don't know why.
That is the blackest Jew I've ever seen other than Sammy Davis Jr. I mean,
former Trump CFO Alan Weisenberg... Nope, that's not him either. I'm missing a picture, but that's okay.
Yeah.
Has been sentenced to 5 months in Rikers prison for perjury. This is the second time that Weisselberg has done time to protect Trump. I do not know what Trump has on Weisselberg, but it can't be as bad as a P-tape.
It found out he's really a black guy, and he's going to tell the whole world.
Ah, that's what this picture's here. Man, I skipped the picture. Okay, forget it.
Who is that guy?
Yeah. Okay, finally, the Trump hush money trial. See, now the picture makes sense. Finally, the Trump hush money trial will begin on April 15th. The witness list will include, among others, Stormy Daniels, Hope Hicks, and Michael Cohen. Every witness against Trump was a Republican who was close to him. Like the old saying says, familiarity breeds contempt, and Trump put the con in contempt. See, the pictures are out of order. Damn it. That's the other picture.
Fine.
I'm G.D. Fenderson, certified forensic humorist, now with new joke technology. Thank you for watching Critical Joke Theory.
Listen, my father taught me in this very room. He said, keep your friends closer. Keep your friends close, but your enemies closer. That's the whole thing with the, I just did that.
Yeah.
I just did that.
I was mid-stroke when you stroked it first.
I'm trying to remember. Now, the Gilligan's Island thing, when they spelled out help with logs, and then Gilligan was like, his pants caught on fire, he was running around, and he was kicking the logs out, and then the logs said something else, so the plane got a whole different message. Do you remember?
No, I don't remember what it said, but I remember the episode.
Yeah, I think a lot of us remember the episode, but, you know, brain farts and whatever... I can't remember what the hell it, but the pilot who saw it, what was that, space capsule or something that saw it. Yeah, because the log were on fire and the space capsule was going over it, and it said something like hello instead of help.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Yeah.
Hello.
With more logs, probably had more logs when he finished than when he started.
Yeah. Hey, LBJ. Now, the LBJ stuff, I have to admit, I knew there were stories about his big dick, but I never heard of him pulling it out and like laying it on.
I've heard it, but I don't know that it was for certain because let's put it there. All the stories that he all mentioned, I also heard. So it must be true, just like my pussycat with the Gabors and Johnny Carson, because I have that. I have people who sell that on tape saying they saw it.
Yeah, I don't know if there's a Mandela effect theory about LBJ's cock, though. I don't know. I think people are hoping there is, though.
I think now you've created a category on Pornhub. Now people are like, yeah, we need to see
no,
this.
No, I get it. But the thing with the Mandela effect, it was a different story before and it's a different story after. This seems to be like a consistent cock story.
Well,
and bull story without the bull.
With LBJ, it's not a Mandela story. It's a what a man story. What a Mandela story.
What a man. Yeah, whatever.
Well, when he when the last guest mentioned Ben Shapiro, that made me laugh because it's like that guy doesn't even understand wet ass pussy. Why would anyone listen to that guy?
you know, I think I talked about this earlier in the week. I don't like Shapiro. I mean, I'm not. I think talks like a fast, nasally little car salesman who talks too fast and thinks he's right about everything and never even considers what he's saying. But I have to agree with him on this idea of censorship as a publisher being allowed to say, "Listen, Fox News has the right to say if you want to work here, you got to be." Far right wing conservative, and I think, and just like MSNBC has but they don't seem to be that anymore. But has the right to say if you want to work here, you got to be far left progressive. They have that right. As long as the government's not involved, I don't have any problem with companies saying if you want to work here, this is our. And I don't think that's censorship. And I think that, the problem with Shapiro is that wasn't his position up until he had to use it to fire Candace Owens. Before that, he was always, it was censorship if people did that. So
now MSNBC, I don't think their credo says you have to be far left, but I think their credo does state now that you have to be anti-Trump and pro-democracy. I don't think you can be on there if you are.
No. I don't know about anti-Trump either. They have some people who are on there who are, I mean, they did go out of their way to hire what's-her-face, Romney's niece there or whatever.
Yeah, but she became...
they only fired her because of public pressure. It wasn't there.
I don't even know if it was public pressure as much as it was the natives got restless.
You know? Oh, yeah. People who work there, the other commentators and all.
Yeah, they're like, hey, we've been talking about pro-democracy, and this woman here was like so anti-democracy. We can't have that.
Right. The Trump trial starts Monday, right? In New York?
Yes, the hush money trial does. The other three were on hold.
So next week should be like a pretty interesting week of having stuff to talk about. I'm sure there will be lots of him coming out of the courtroom saying, the judge,
judge is trying to castrate me. He needs to let my pants out so the boys can breathe, that right. kind of stuff.
Right.
His daughter gave stuff money.
To react to and talk about without having an eclipse at all.
I'm just tired of hearing that an elderly man whine all the time. It's like, shut up and take
something. Hey, don't talk about Matt like that, okay? He's the host of this show.
I was going to say, in defense of us old men, also, because some AI called me a lovable, grumpy curmudgeon. That's what AI called it.
That's sweet.
And I didn't tell it to say that about me. It went out, and I guess it listened to a couple of the programs. I don't know where it got that from.
Even your own family wouldn't say something that nice about you. No,
the lovable part you could take out of it, but the grumpy curmudgeon part, it seems to be based in, you have to know me, you have to know something about me to say that, and it's pretty accurate, I have to say.
This old battle axe.
Yeah. But on that note, I do think, because I said that to RFK, you know, it said that in his comments on Twitter, like, when are you going to stop fucking just, we've had 4 years of Trump just constantly complaining and playing the victim and whining about stuff. You want us to elect you? You're basically saying you're just going to do the same shit that he did, which is every day bombard with 750 messages on social media about victimization and not get anything done. This is the platform you're running on. The whiner old man, I soiled my Depends platform. And it's like, but then his people, his bots or whatever, I had to turn off all replies from that because they were just attacking me like crazy for saying that. But I think it's absolutely true. If you follow RFK Jr. If you follow him on social media at all, he's just a nonstop 24/7, every 3 minutes, a new post, a new tweet, a new whatever about how he's a victim.
I gotta say, I need to reach these young kids out there. That's why I'm on Twitter all the time. But I would urge everyone to check out my new channel on Pornhub. It's a very specific category of elderly, muscular men making love to Jewish women.
Do you have a subcategory about snorting creatine off the ass crack of a hooker?
I gotta say, GD, I love just snorting creatine. It helps me get through the day. Sometimes a little bump of Adderall, too.
I had a joke about that at some point during the vaccine nonsense, where the guys who were screaming loudly about not wanting to take the vaccine, these are people I know who I've snorted coke with in a men's room or snorted or off a toilet seat, or powder you bought from a 13-year-old kid in the street, but you had no problem putting that in your body, but you're not going to trust what a doctor wants to put in you. It was kind of bizarre. The loudest complaint is about that with the guys who snorted crack off a hooker's ass.
When I still had a job, there were several people that died there because of COVID, because they wouldn't get vaccines. And yeah. And they were they fit the description of like the people that should get the vaccine, and they didn't, and it took them out in no time.
I used to work at a company. No, actually, yeah, Random House. I can say that one. Random House. I used to work at Penguin Random House, and we lost a lot of people per capita who would not, because I live in a very, very conservative neck of the woods, and they wouldn't get vaccinated, and they just kept dying.
Well, as you know, I am a registered Catholic, and I don't mind if people don't get shots. It's called let God sort them out, the weak from the strong.
It's kind of scary that you have to register as a Catholic. Like who's paying attention to the registry and like, I don't know, what does that actually mean to be a registered Catholic?
I'm not sure if you have noticed, but the Catholics have not had a great run here of late. You know, those priests, like I tell them, you gotta fuck Jewish women like Cheryl Hines.
Yeah, I like the fact that just the sheer fact that you mentioned you were a registered Catholic just reminded me of that song, creatine is sacred, creatine is great, from the Monty Python movie.
I don't remember that song.
Yeah.
Now, I know it's almost impossible to get Ron Kane and RFK in the same room together, but not really important for RFK Junior to talk about this. But Ron, if you're still there, Ron, you're still there. Are you still a? Because I think he's. If you follow him on Twitter, and I don't think it's pretty obvious you don't follow him on Twitter. I don't think he's going anywhere. I think he's in this until November, no matter what. You still think he's dropping out of the race by summer?
I think by summer, because I mean his whole family has abandoned him. He just fired somebody because saying they were going to destroy Biden or something like that. But I mean, if he keeps pumping that Kennedy money into it, but I just don't see a point where someone says, you know, this is kind of like a losing venture.
Well, most of his money's coming from that his vice president, though, Shanahan. I mean, I agree with you. I think he'll be out in August, and because I think that things are just going to get just too real for him. People were playing tapes of him saying things that he wants to deny, you know, over and over
again. He doesn't have an issue with saying, I never said that. And then they play the tape and he's, well, you took me out of context. You didn't let me explain the meaning. So
yeah, that's what's going to get old. That's going to get old to him after a while.
I don't, well, you want to go to my bookie and let's place a wager on, like, friendly gentleman. Here's the deal. The winner of the bet has to go babysit Willie in an airport for a week. No, the loser of the bet. The loser of the bet has to. Why would the winner? Have to?
That's not good.
I never said that. I just want to say I never said that. I'll play back the tape. Well, you took me out of context. I was meant to say I misspoke.
So the winner has to babysit him for 1 week and the loser for two.
For you know something.
And I will. Right now, I'm going to go follow Robert Kennedy Jr. Because as
don't do it to yourself, Ron. Wow. No.
Now you'll know.
No, I need it for content, so I can keep working that.
Absolutely, you definitely do. But here's the thing: they're spending so much money. She's putting so much money into all these commercials she's doing. Like she went to Yuma, Arizona, filmed like an infomercial on the border situation down there. She's all day long. She's filming stuff, and it's very well produced. So there's money behind it. She's just pumping. So I don't think, you know, buyer's remorse being what it is, people who invest that much money, they're not necessarily going to quit before they see the results. And I don't think
she wants to quit. I don't think she'll want to quit, but I think he will. I don't think because I think she really wants to be vice president. She wants to be.
She had the look of like she was just walking around backstage, and he was like, "You are my vice president. Get up there."
Now, as I pointed out last week, Trump has never said a bad word about RFQ yet. But he came out and fired his first shot at Trump. Like, he hasn't said anything bad about Trump, really. He's been basically beating up on Biden. But yesterday or the day before, he came out and attacked Trump. I'm just waiting for Trump to hear about that and then start give him a name like, you know, blowjob voice or whatever. You know, Trump, I don't do justice to Trump's ability to create insult monikers on people. But
I did read the... I did read the other day, like all the networks got together, and it was like unprecedented. They wrote this letter telling all the candidates, you need to debate, like demanding it. And it was so weird because like the networks that are
entering them together. Common purpose. It's the ratings. It's money. They need the content. They need, and that's like Mike Tyson and Jake Paul. It's like you know, for them, it's an event that it's not pay per view, but they definitely are relying on that being. You know, Trump is if nothing else, he is a tremendous attention grabbing ratings getter.
Hoo-la. Oh, sorry. I was thinking whore, but okay.
Oh, that too. Yeah. So there's no doubt that they all have a common interest in broadcasting that debate.
Yes.
It's out of curiosity because they want to see. But we all know what it would be. It would just be, you know, Trump whining and bitching that everything is terrible. And Joe's going to be like, can we like talk about like what's actually going on? because that's his whole bit. Like, everything is terrible, but he can't back anything up.
Right.
And the things that are good are things that he make up. You know, he was like, I had a great economy my fourth year after just before I beat Obama in the 2020 election.
Well, they are the Republicans establishment and the Trump establishment is starting to panicking a little bit about what they did to themselves with this abortion issue, because, yes. You know, the Arizona thing. Now, they lobbied for that. They got that to happen. It's in the news, which we didn't play today. But Trump doesn't want it now because he knows that that's a bad for his chances of being elected again. And all the people who are loyal to him have turned on, including Carrie Lake, who is in Arizona, who pushed for that.
Yeah, she pushed for that law big time.
Right. Now she's saying it was a bad idea. And like they should. And so yesterday there was an attempt to get the Arizona legislature to reassess that, and the Republican Party in Arizona shut that down. So yeah. That could, you know, there's a lot of, who knows how that's going to play out. I don't think the Republican, the Christian conservative women are ever, they'll go along with it, at least, you know, even though it's a shot at women, they'll go along with it just because I think
there are two
wives.
I think because they've done all this shit with abortion, they did a great job of mobilizing all these young women who are in their early 20s, who enjoy sex as you should for a man or a woman. And they're like, fuck you. And I think it will be a bloodbath for him.
Wait, back up. I'm supposed to enjoy sex?
Yep.
Fuck. I always felt like it was a chore. Maybe I should have come at it with that perspective.
How much are you charging for it? Because that makes a difference also. How much money are you making at it?
I basically mortgaged my whole life for it.
Matt likes to eat two plates of spaghetti and let all that pasta say, let's go do it now. Right.
I want spaghetti and meatballs so bad now.
I've managed my sexual business very poorly. I need a financial sexual advisor or something.
I'm not even allowed in that one ice cream parlor. I don't know why.
Well, my mustache is telling me it's time to leave. Wrap this up.
Hearing voices.
Yeah, I have a gig tonight. You got a gig tonight?
No. I got gardening.
Gardening tonight?
I have errands to run. It's gardening related. My put my mower and my snow thrower in the shop to be, you know, for maintenance, and they're both ready. So I got to pick them up this afternoon because I don't.
I would leave the blower and tell them I'll be back in October to pick that up.
No, I want my snow thrower because it's also fun to use, you know, during the summer.
Right. All right, Ron, you have a gig tonight, don't you? I know you do.
Tonight, now I'm just going to hit a mic tonight. Tomorrow, I got, I'll be in Grantville at Laughingstock Comedy Club for the Kenan Thompson. Laughingstock. Yeah. Kenan Thompson showcase that he is not going to be at.
All right.
But he's got his name and he's making money off of it.
Just so you know, I mean, if any of your gigs, and when you post them on social media, also share them on the Mind Dog TV group. So, I mean, for whatever it helps, it definitely, there are probably some people in your area that are followers of the page, and we'll see it. So don't forget to do that. That's all. Sure. I'm kicking you guys out. Have a great weekend. I'll see you Monday. And bye for now. All right, get out of my room. Get out of my room. Get out of my room. I'm telling me, get out of my room. Thanks for being here today. I hope you enjoyed. I'm sorry I let you down with the spiritual channel. I'll get back in touch with him. You know, not that it would have been a little bit contentious, I'm sure, because I would have asked him to channel OJ or something. Yeah, you know, prove it. Let me see you channel somebody. Even Kurt Cobain. Get me in touch. Get me Kurt Cobain. It'll be a celebrity interview anyway. So we'll get back in touch with him. But Peter Serafine was a very interesting and non-contentious discussion. And I'd love to have him back and talk more about that kind of stuff. Anyway, that's the show for today. Thanks for coming. Have a great weekend. And don't forget to turn on your radio. Bye for now.
now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now.